welcome everybody. We're just so happy to have you here tonight, and I want you to be seated. You know, the thing about it is many people have different ideas of what they want in church, what they expect in church, what they've learned should happen in a church meeting. But there are very few people out of the many on the planet Earth right now who are interested in what God says He wants in church. And He's made it very clear what He wants in church. He wants tongues and interpretation of tongues. And many of you sit around for a long time, you don't have those yet, and you need to talk to Pop about what's the problem between you and him, or what you've been allowing to go on in your life that would cause any kind of hindrances from that which He wants you to do. Because Father's got a purpose for His church, and people say they want to do the will of God, they want to do what Father wants, but yet at the same time, we don't see a lot of people participating. They're not really anxious about it or concerned about it to the point where they're desperate about it. See, I was saying today, what is the price of revival? Well, the price of revival is doing what God said to do at any cost. You know, I look around tonight and I recognize that many people still don't know how to be filled with the Spirit and speak to themselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Still recognize that. You know, I tweeted something today on my way here. And as soon as I tweeted it, fire of God came on me so radically. Just fire of God. Power and the glory of God. Just Father saying, that's me. You talk on my behalf. And I said, it's been said that you should feed the sheep and milk the goats. But I say, feed the sheep and get a stick after the goats. So tonight as I'm talking and you figure you got a stick coming after you, you know what is really happening. Because the same word that feeds the sheep is a stick to the goat. And I don't expect that there's any in here. I run them all off. They show up. I just preach the word and say, Lord, I don't know what's happened. I don't know who you brought here in this time. But you know what? We're just going to preach the word like you tell us to preach it. What are we doing? We are so stirred up with a zeal for Father's house. We're not interested in participating with the things that everybody, the populace, like to have, which is all the tables of merchandise, all of the Laodicean things where we're preaching in a way to where men can tolerate it. God don't preach in a way which men can tolerate. From the very first time that God uttered His voice before His people, they said, we can't stand to hear Him preach. We need another preacher. Moses, you go listen to him. You come be our preacher because we can't handle listening to him. He's a poor pastor. Poor preacher. We'll all die listening to him. On that day, they cried out, give us Barabbas. We want Barabbas instead of Jesus. Today, there are many people that say that they are followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, but they don't live out the life of Jesus. In other words, how many people in the pulpit are Jesus? And how many people in the pulpit are the populist opinion, the Barabbas, the replacement for him, the convenient substitute? We know Barabbas around here. Hallelujah. And I pray tonight that you grab a hold of the meaning of what Father is calling His people to come into. And don't sit there like a bunch of duds, lifeless people, but you get moving in your spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. Mon zikanamaya. Zona mangea tiboranaya. You get moving in a maseta romo sataya. Now, I know how hard it is to live all your life and live all day long serving yourself and then try to come now serve God. It just don't work in here because there's a spirit of truth in here. Somebody said, I used to speak in tongues till I came to your meeting. Well, praise God, you got delivered. Somebody said, I came to your meeting, I was fine. I came to your meeting, I had a headache. Yeah, that's exactly a manifestation of what you need to be delivered out of. And these things are true. These things are true. And tonight I want to minister to you about what Father wants in His house. And I have ministered it over and over and over again. And God's servants have ministered it over and over again. And people are forgetful hearers, and there's a category in the Word of God for that. And people are, and the reason people are forgetful hearers because they turn to their labors. They turn to their own earthly interest. Don't turn to your own labors and to your own earthly interest. That is all going to be burned up. That's all going to perish with the using. Dear baby, you don't know. You don't know what kind of jeopardy is on your life today. You don't understand it. Paul, who walked in the fullness of Father's glory, was pleading that he might obtain the resurrection. Hello. He would say, well, I know, and I've got an insight. You don't know anything as you ought to know. You ought to understand. Paul said, I came in the fullness of the ministry of Jesus, fully preached the gospel, and yet you still hear him saying, agonizing, that I may know him in the fellowship of his suffering, that he may conformable unto his death, that if by any means possible, I too might attain to the resurrection. So there's this always ongoing, in the heart of God's people, this always ongoing depth of great hunger, no matter what's been happening in your life. It's a proof, positive, that you're sealed to the Spirit. There's a lot of people disinterested and under the influence of demon spirits, and they don't realize it, because the Spirit of holiness will produce within you Father's love, Father's servitude, Father's submission, not any other kind of response. See, what Father wants in his house is joy unspeakable and full of glory. And when there's other attitudes, it ain't what Father has for us. It isn't the Spirit of truth. What Father wants in his house is he wants peace that passes understanding. He wants us to grab a hold of the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and there be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, and understanding that his church is the fullness of him that filleth all things. So when you take those two verses of scripture and you put them together, you recognize what kind of love needs to be manifesting among the people of God for the things of the Spirit to be made a reality, for the things that Father's purpose to be in his house to be seen. The church is supposed to be the very description and look like the very beauty and splendor of Jesus Christ instead of strife and envy. And I can feel strife in here right now. I can feel the human spirit in here right now, closely akin to a demon power. And I got a stick for you, because you don't belong in Papa's house. Your mind and your attitudes don't belong in Father's house. I don't care how much you say you're Christian, how much you fast, how much you pray, how many miracles you work. If the love of God is not there, if the submission to the church doesn't exist, if the flow of the Holy Ghost isn't in your life, something is terribly wrong, and I'm not having it in Papa's house, because the zeal of the Lord has eaten me up, and the zeal of the Lord ate Christ Jesus up, and I'm in him and he's in me. And he took and he turned over the tables of merchandise where men say, I want to do what I want to do in the Father's house. It's my business, and you can't tell me what to do. I'm going to tell you right now, that will find its place eternally in a place called the lake of fire. That attitude, that way of living, will find itself in a place called Gehenna, which is usually translated hell. It's about time that God's people grab a hold of the reality of what's before them. People talk to me about it all the time. Well, how close do you think the end of the world is? Listen, it doesn't even matter. Your end's coming up real quickly. Your number's about to be called. Amen. And we don't have to wonder. Nobody has to wonder where you're at. No one has to sort you out. The Word of God has already sorted you out. The Father's Word's already divided between the chaff and the wheat. The wind of the Spirit constantly divides between the chaff and the wheat. There's no reason for me to have to come in here and feel anything other than the love of God, the submission of God, and the flow of the Holy Ghost. There's no reason for me to have to come in to his house and have to start rebuking people right off the bat. Listen, if you don't belong here, you should leave and never come back. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't belong here, you can find out whether you belong here right now or not. If you are totally in love with this ministry and what I'm saying, you belong here. And if you're not, you shouldn't be here. You should go somewhere else. And I hope you make heaven. And I doubt you will. Because such a decision to walk out on God like that and to condone such evil attitudes is ultimately a description that there is already reprobacy and apostasy there. You hear me? Now, I'm here to talk to you tonight about Father's house and what he wants in his house. Father wants tongues and interpretation in his house. He said he wants in his house apostles. He wants in his house prophets. He wants in his house teachers, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 28. That's what he wants in his house. He wants miracles and the working of miracles in his house. And he doesn't want it to be a working of miracles that would be on the line of where he said to them that work miracles, depart from me, I never knew you. He wants the kind of miracles that come out of the realms of the Holy Ghost, because the church is set on fire by the Holy Ghost, giving themselves over to the things of the Spirit and walking in that love of God that produces it. Hallelujah. Walking in the very life and person of Jesus Christ. Things are starting to get better in here. Right now. I'm telling you right now, because the fan's blowing, the wind's blowing, the chaff's leaving.
I don't want Chaffee around here. And we've been sitting in here with an arrogant attitude. Why? Because it's gonna stop the flow of the Holy Ghost. I'm a revivalist. We revivalist people. People that don't want God and don't want the things of the Spirit and don't want what Christ Jesus described in His Word have no place in His church, in His house. Because they're rebels. They're rebels. This is, God does not run the kingdom of humanism. A demonic power called Satan runs the kingdom of humanism, where everybody gets whatever it is that they like. That is Laodicean. It leaves the people. That's not what Father wants in His house. Father wants divine order in His house. He wants the Holy Ghost to be absolutely in charge. And guess what? Guess who the Holy Spirit is going to hold responsible as to whether or not He is given the place to be absolutely in charge or not? His apostles, prophets, and teachers. And then fundamentally, at the end of the conversation, you, because you're going to decide whether or not you're going to be a part of what God wants, or whether you're going to do your own thing, or whether you're going to just continue to salve your own iniquity, your own stubbornness, your own disinterest, your own distraction, your own willingness to go, to say, I'll go, but not going. You don't want to do that, people. Listen, there is a revival fire that is now burning in the midst of God's church, and He's going to bring forth people that are clearly identified as His, and there's going to be a clear distinction made between those who are His and who are not His. Amen. And people don't understand this. They don't understand that there has got to be chaos in the midst of such stubbornness. There's got to be chaos in the midst of such rebellion, that there is going to have to be somebody who's going to stand up and say, look, we're not going to tolerate these things that don't belong to Father's house anymore. I don't care how versed you are in men's doctrines. I don't care how versed you are in the opinion of men about what should go on and what shouldn't go on. Who's going to start hungering and thirsting rather for what Father wants in His house? Who's going to start hungering and thirsting for what Father, how Father birthed His church? He birthed His church in a means by which the church should continually be propagated. The means which the Spirit of the Lord was poured out upon all flesh. Hallelujah. And out of that, the Holy Ghost being poured out upon all flesh, Father began to see produced within the heart of man the praise that He's been looking for. In other words, the worship, the kind of interaction, the kind of relationship. I mean, Father wants to say the relationship Father wants to have with us is modeled over and again in the Old Testament when he came to Abraham in Genesis chapter 18. When He came to Moses, and when He came to Moses and the elders and in Exodus and in Numbers, and He sat down and He communed with them, and He ate with them. Father's looking for a communication between us and Him that is so intimate, that is so real. All this fictitious Christianity, all these ideas about what we think we should have, always wanting something for ourselves, has got to come to an end. It has to begin now about giving Father what he's demanded, what He desires, what He wants, what He's purposed, what He poured out the blood of His only begotten Son to produce within our lives. Hallelujah. And start reading the Word of God differently. You know, when most of Paul's address to the church, the majority of Paul's address to the church was all about them giving themselves to living in holiness and purity, to live in and walking before God in an intimate relationship where that they would find Christ Jesus being revealed in their conduct and their character, which was fundamentally revealed in the relationship with one another and their behavior in the house of God. That's the primary focus of Paul's ministry. And out of that realm ultimately comes all the things that he described, for example, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 concerning the glorious church functioning in the activity of the Holy Ghost. Because reality of it is, we're not really truly submitted to the Holy Spirit until we're willing to walk in the ways of obedience to the nature of Christ Jesus in a place called holiness, in a place called purity. Somebody said, well, what about the sin? Well, the sin is the first thing you need to put a big cancellation on in your life. Amen. The sin is the first thing that if you really are serious about revival, want to pay the price of revival, you're going to have to be willing to quit hanging out and carousing with demon spirits. Praise God for the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us and washes us if we do sin. But I hope it becomes an if instead of a when. For many people, it's a when instead of an if. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yes. The Bible doesn't say when you sin. It says if you sin. I mean, because we can walk in a glorious fellowship and relationship with the Lord and a consecration and a commitment to Him. Wow, that we don't want the death. I don't like death. I don't like sorrow. I don't like agony. I don't like pain. I don't like disease. I don't like sickness. I don't like torment. I don't like depression. I don't like oppression. I don't like anything that darkness brings. I don't like being in the dark. Not naturally nor spiritually. I like the light. I mean, turn the lights on. Open up the windows, you know. I want the fresh air. Hallelujah. Praise God. We make up our mind. When we make up our mind, we're willing to do the will of the Father and pay the price for revival and pay the price for the move of God and be a salt unto the nations, a light unto the world. It's easy then for the Holy Ghost to begin to have an expression through our lives, because Satan doesn't have no place to put intimidation and fears and accusation and strife. God, the Holy Ghost is never going to begin to move in the midst of strife and accusation and finger pointing and all of the things that men do out of the realms of that carnality that they imprison to. What is it the Father is calling us to do? He's calling us to so come into a place where Jesus is revealed in our life on the fundamental levels of how we treat people, how we treat our husband, how we treat our wife, how we treat our children, how we treat one another. I mean, this is the same thing that you'll hear out of the Apostle Peter, and this is the same thing you're going to hear out of the Apostle John, the same thing you're going to hear out of the writings of James, the brother of Jesus. It's all about how are we going to live our lives in a way to where that we are yielded to the Holy Ghost, and He and the very nature of Jesus Christ and the very goodness of God is being made manifest through our life. But it doesn't ever stop, you know, this whole understanding or prevent or limit or slow down this whole understanding of the glorious ministry of Jesus Christ being made manifest through our life with greater works. And those greater works are never going to come till you begin to hunger for the works. And then begin to step into the works. Hallelujah. You're not going to step into the works until you're hungering for the works. You see, people talk about how the fire comes and burns up all the problems. Fire, I don't care who you are. Fire doesn't come up and fire. The fire of God doesn't come to burn all your problems up. The fire of God falls on the perfect sacrifice. Now, just stick with the type. Oh, just bring me just some old fouled up old sacrifice, blind in one eye, and, you know, just hobbling along, and it can be all spotted up, and I'll just turn my fire on it. I'll send my fire on it, and then we'll just clean it all up in the fire, and then it'd be acceptable to me. That doesn't even exist. Give me a perfect sacrifice. Give me one just like I told you to present to me. And then I will cause my fire to fall upon that sacrifice as evidence that it is acceptable unto me. Now, Christ Jesus made us holy and acceptable. And isn't that wonderful that He's done it so? He's done it so perfectly and so instantaneously that at Cornelius' house, we don't know when they got saved. And we don't know whether they got saved first or baptized in the Holy Ghost first. And we just know it happened at the same time, you know. We just know what happened at the same time. You notice there, they didn't repeat, come up, respond to an altar call, and repeat after me. Now, Jesus, amen. I take you as my personal Lord and Savior and ask you to cleanse me with your blood, and I confess it. You know, and all that's fine and wonderful and everything, but it's not producing the Cornelius house results. Absolutely. It's not producing the results of the church that Christ Jesus established, that was born on the day that the Holy Ghost came upon it. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, at this very moment in time, you give me a people that's like Cornelius' house that are hungry for truth. I'm telling you, I watched over and again where the Holy Ghost comes upon them while we yet speak. You give me a hard-hearted Western church all mixed with all kinds of stuff, and it's a wonder that anything is going to happen in terms of what it looks like with respect to the expressions of the Holy Ghost. We all excited that somebody laughed, that somebody smiled, that somebody clapped. I mean, it looks like revival if everybody's doing the same thing at the same time. It looks like a great move of God because it's so rare seen. If everybody stood up and started clapping and shouting and being happy about some result or something, you'd think it's full-blown revival, outpouring of God's Holy Ghost. Why? Because it's so rare seen. Everybody's scattered. Everybody's doing their own will. They don't care about Papa's will. They don't care about the will of the Father which is in heaven. You listen to me. Because I'm going to tell you right now, Father's more passionate about it than I am right now. He's more intense about it than I am right now. Christ Jesus is more intense about it. I cannot express to you how intense, how radical the Holy Ghost is about this message right now. Where that which is belongs to that which is holy has been turned into that which belongs to men. Huh? When that which is sacred has been made profane just simply because it has been altered enough to accommodate men. Hallelujah. Listen to me here, people. I want to jerk you right around over here and get you walking back on the straight and the narrow.
Amen.
I mean, dear people, come on. I mean, you think about what has your life been like today? What is your life? Was your life about today recognizing what Father wants for his house? Have your thoughts been about the reality of what Jesus purpose to do in revealing himself through you in the context of the church so that you've been able to give yourself all day, yielding yourself, preparing yourself, making yourself ready for the meeting tonight so that you could flow in tongues and interpretation of tongues because it's important for Papa's house. It's in his house. So that you could flow in the praise of the spiritual praise of the psalm and the hymn and the spiritual song, which is what Father has ordained for his house, which is actually, if it's not going on in your life today, throughout the day, if you're not being filled with the Spirit throughout the day, then it really just becomes a show. I mean, I translated Matthew 22 and 23 today. Jesus constantly saying, fools, blind, hypocrites, you got a good show going on the outside, but inside nothing's going on. Huh? You make it look like you always serving God, but in reality, it's only for appearance sake. Hello. Now, people, I tell you right now, when I read things like that, I get shook to my core of my spirit. I'm not going to say, those people down the street, I'm looking at Father going, Father, I want everything about my life to be submitted to you. I want no hypocrisy. No, I don't want to be no fool. Huh? I don't want to be no blind person. Lord, I want to have some kind of pretense, Lord. I want the fire of your Holy Ghost burning my spirit in every way, in every dimension. I don't even have a minute off. I don't want a minute off. Hallelujah. Amen. I love the presence of the Lord. I can live in heaven forever.
Yeah.
I don't need a break. Oh, what do you expect us all be living in heaven forever? Yeah. Why you expect us to be living in heaven all the time? Don't you know we got to work? I don't know what you know. I have no idea what you're talking about. No idea how your mind has flipped things so upside down that you can't even reason or think properly. You listen to me. And this is the situation that we find ourselves in. People, everybody's believing it according to their, nobody's submitted to nothing. And we're not looking for people to be submitted to us. We're looking for people to be submitted to the Word of God. And there's very few places you find people who really truly submitted to the Word of God. They submitted to their own ideas. They're submitted to their own thinking. They're submitted to their own wishes. They're submitted to their own wants. They behave like whatever they feel at the time. They choose to do with whatever thing strikes them as being something that'll make them feel good. And that's how people live their lives. And they say they're going to heaven. You're not going to heaven. You say they're right with God. You're not right with God. Period. Jesus said, they that did the will of the Father. That's what he made it. He made it very clear. He said, I'm going to tell you what the most important thing you got to do. You got to start seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost will correct you tonight if you're willing to be corrected. Huh? You feel like I got a stick on you? Okay, you know who you are. You feel like a sheep? You're getting excited. Oh, man, I love this kind of preaching. I said, listen to this kind of preaching from anybody. I'm not dropping my head and looking around wondering, oh no, is he talking about me? Or trying to go up down, you know, anything because I feel a little awkward. Huh? Because this one person said he's talking down to the people. Nobody talking down to nobody. That's the pride of life sticking its head up too high. Whatever, you know what I'm saying? It's about getting right. It's about getting real. It's about shaking up the house. Huh? I'd like to listen to you how you talk to your children when they're misbehaving. Huh? I'd like to see how you respond to your children when they won't respond properly to correction. Huh? I'd like to see how merciful you are when you told them to go in and clean their room 10 times in a row and they still don't got it. Huh? I hear some of the feedback, but I'm looking at you going, well, what have you been doing? Because they're just acting just like you. spiritually, they're acting just like you. You've got different things that you want, different results that you want, different from you. Okay, because you don't have to clean up your toys and put them in a toy box. You don't have to make your bed. And what I'm, you know what I'm saying, in that sense, with the same kind of struggle. But you got different things going on that has behind it the same spiritual problem that causes that lack of cooperation, causes that lack of obedience. And it's about time to get that stuff straightened out. It's about time you start putting the things that Father wants first. What does Father want in your life tonight? Does Father want singing? Yeah, He wants singing. But He wants singing that comes right out of the realms of the Spirit. He wants it coming right out of the realms of praise. He wants it coming right out of the Basta Remasia Tolomogia Rabatasaya. Hallelujah. Is the place, some people think the place to practice tongues and interpretation tongues is in church. It's at your home. Hallelujah. It's in your prayer meeting. Hallelujah. That you're not having every day. Many people. Because they are too busy for heaven. If you're not living in heaven, what are you living in? Oh, so we're living in limbo. We neither in heaven nor earth as we in limbo. We in the earthly realm. Are you in the earthly realm, are you? See, there are many people, what did Jesus say? He said to these Pharisees, He says, you actually are preventing or denying those who want, said you don't live under the reign of heaven. We translate it, you don't live under the kingdom of heaven, or you don't enter into the reign of heaven, or you don't enter into the kingdom of heaven. And those who do live under the reign, the rulership, the kingdom of heaven, you deny them. Now, I want you to understand, when we're talking about living under the kingdom, we're going to tell people talk about kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God, and they always want to make it in the future. It's not just in the future, it's the present right now. Are you living under the reign of heaven? Are you living under the reign of the culture of the United States of America? Are you living under the culture and the reign of your boss? Living under the culture and the reign of the things that you demand that you have, because everybody told you it was absolutely essential if you were going to be a good boy, a good girl, if you were going to be an upstanding citizen, if you were going to be a person to really fit in, then you've got to have items 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and therefore you've got to be a slave to the society and to the system in order to be able to maintain items 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And so God, you and your kingdom are going to have to be on hold for later. Seeking first the kingdom and your righteousness isn't something that we really have time to do right now, because after all, we're so busy making about 95% of everything that we make to spend upon ourselves, and we're going to throw you 5% and tell you that we're advancing the kingdom. Okay, let me make it a little bit better. Okay, Lord, we're going to be slaves to the system, and we're going to spend 85% of what we make on ourselves, and 15% of it we're going to throw it to you and say we're advancing the kingdom and fully participating in the will of the Father for our lives. Am I getting across to you? I'm drunk in the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I'm feeling very good. And I want you to be able to feel very good, too. I'm glad that you feel good. You know that everybody who knows that the Lord feels real good, everybody who doesn't know the Lord is going, what on earth is He talking about? Oh, no, is He talking about me? Am I the person? Am I the centerpiece of the conversation tonight? You know what? I mean, I pray that every person here makes themselves the centerpiece of the conversation in a very positive way. I see people smiling right now, and I know that they're making themselves the centerpiece of the conversation in a very positive way. I see people frowning right now, and I may notice that they making themselves the centerpiece of the conversation in a very negative way. One is obedience to God and submission to the Lord, and yes, Lord, I want you and everything you want for me, and the other is the opposite of all that I don't want to go into at this moment, because I've got too many other things to say. What is it that Father wants? Where when you begin to think about the price of revival, when you begin to just think about the will of the Father, what is it? And if you've identified it, is it really what you're doing with your life? Does Father really want your bank account to be bigger? Does He really want you to get a promotion at work? Is that top on the list? You think about it. Because He told us very clearly, I want you to seek first the kingdom of God and my righteousness. Don't seek after these things. And yet we run and seek after these things. I know we do, because it shuts down the moving of the Holy Ghost in our life simply because we're disobeying God. We expect that we could disobey God and somehow get Him to fill us with His glory and overwhelm us with His presence. It's nonsense. Start obeying God. Yeah. Somebody said, do I need to go quit my job? You don't need to quit your job. You need to get your mind right. Amen. You know what I say? Your mind is messed up. You don't think properly. You are unwilling to live in the mind of Christ, which is literally being ruled by the Word of God. You're unwilling to live in the mind of the Spirit, which is literally, truly to be ruled by the mind of the Word of God, to be ruled by the Word, to be ruled by the Spirit of grace. Yes. God the Holy Ghost, isn't it wonderful that he says Spirit of grace? Yes. He's holy, he's fiery, he's not compromised. You know what? The Lord will not compromise with one single little bit of a lie. He won't. No. We want him to. Oh, please. Oh, God, I don't understand what's wrong with you. I don't understand why you, I did this and you said in your word that you were supposed to do the other. I did these things and I'm still waiting for you to do your things. No, Father, if Father could speak out loud to you, he'd say, no, you did not do a quarter of what I told you to do, and you did it with the wrong spirit and the wrong heart and the wrong attitude, and I'm not going to bless that. You're going to get it right. The sacrifice is going to be right. Yes. Hallelujah. We're always blaming God. He's coming up short. God never come up short. He watched over his word and hasted it to bring it to pass. God is faithful. It's just one of the fundamental attributes of the Father is that he's faithful. As much as he is full of love, he's full of faithfulness. I'm telling you right now, if you're not getting the results that the word of God described, it's because you're not doing what God told you to do. Oh, well, I've been doing it. You haven't. Listen, man, you're so up and down, we don't know which one you are half the time. It's somewhere in between. We catch you, you know, basically, it's hard to tell. Is he up or is he down? Is she up or is she down? Now, how are they doing? Toss to and fro, back and forth, double judgments. I mean, God wants you to get a consecrated heart and a consecrated will and no longer have any other expression in your life except for thanksgiving unto him, praises unto him. Hallelujah. And you'll begin to find wonderful and a glorious life. You begin to do that, those things. You know, you just think about it. Listen to me. You know, listen, understand this. Jesus stood being tempted and tested of the devil. If he would have listened to the lie, if he would have compromised with the lie in the least little bit, then all the purposes of God, all the will of God, all the blessings of God, and all the plan of God would have been completely shut down, and all mankind would have followed as sheep, following the powers of darkness, being led into destruction, and there would have been no way out. How about you? How much lie do you listen to? Can you hear me?
Yes.
It is amazing. It is amazing. I mean, listen to me, you people. You listen to me. Because I can tell when people are listening and when they're not listening. I can tell. It's a spiritual thing. It's a spiritual thing. That's why Jesus says, Shema, hear. And then he finally said, forget it. Those who have ears to hear, hear. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
The glory of this of God is here. The glory of the Spirit of the Lord is here. The person Christ Jesus is even here. And you know, think for me, when we start singing songs like we were singing, "Here I am, here we are, Lord, standing in your presence." Man, I'm telling you right now, for me, that's going straight to Father. I'm talking directly to God because I've got a relationship with him. He's not a figment of somebody's imagination. He's not an idea or a character in a book. Uh-huh. He's not an icon of a religion. He is living, real person to me. I interact with him as such. Hallelujah. And that's why all of a sudden there begins to be heavenly manifestations in our life. Because as we walk with him, and as we enter into this place of relationship with him, putting what he wants first, not what I want. There's so many people, they've never moved past the childish behavior spiritually of promoting what they want because they throw, you know, a child will throw a fit. Anybody notice that? Is anybody besides Leslie? A child will throw a fit to get what it wants. And many parents will abdicate. Papa's not abdicating. You throw all the fits you want. Many people spiritually have never moved past fit throwing so that they can have their will, so they can have it their way. And usually that all the time, they're blaming it on some other human being because that's the only way they could get away, you know, consciously, you know, in their conscience with throwing those fits so often. They're up against some man, some leader's will, huh? And not God's. But in reality, all you got to do is spend a little bit more time reading the Word of God instead of doing all those other things, and you quickly discover, I'm not fighting against men, I'm fighting against God. I'm not throwing a fit against men, I'm throwing a fit against God. People, I'm here tonight delivering to you the word of God. I'm not delivering to you the word of men. If I was delivering to you the word of men, my goodness, don't listen to the thing I got to say. Or you can argue all you want, whatever. You know, if you got so much love that you're willing to stay around and listen to somebody who's doing nothing but spouting the ideas and philosophies of men, then that'd take a lot of, well, that's not even love, that's just stupidity. You need to go to some place where you can get built up with the word of God, unless you be spoiled by tradition. Spoiled. What is spoiled fruit good for? Sit at the table and brag about and say, this is going to be the best thing you ever ate? To juice? No, spoiled fruit is good for nothing but to be thrown away. And Father's saying, listen, philosophies and traditions will spoil you after the rudiments of the world, and now you won't be trained after the fashion of Christ Jesus. I want to train. God, the Holy Ghost here, train you after the fashion of Christ Jesus. And I mean, goodness gracious, you talk about the long suffering of the Lord. What if you had to, from this day forward, go to a church that was all dried up and there was no moving of the Holy Ghost, and you yourself never really learned how to step into that place, and so for the rest of your life, you got to spend it on this earth without any moving of the Holy Ghost really in your life, without any real signs and wonders, because you're not connected with the supply of the Spirit, as is described by Paul. Paul says this, that the connectivity of the supply of the Spirit comes by a group of people or by two people who are properly connected in the body of Christ, even as joints are connected and tendons and tissue and ligaments are properly connected, each member to each member, all the way joined unto the head, and describing that fully as Christ. And you just get disconnected, and there's no flow. There's no flow. I'm telling you right now, if that doesn't sound like a nightmare to you, it does sound like a nightmare to me. I would say that probably one of the things that I'm most earnest about, which basically creates within me the greatest, if it were, the greatest of all fear and concern, is being without His manifest presence in my life, being without His anointing. When I stand at the crossroads of temptation to choose, I say, no, God, I do not want to in any way. I don't want less of your manifest presence. I want more, and I'm not going to compromise what precious little I have. There is so much more to have. This wonderful grace to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, which I am. I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. And tonight, I'm telling you right now, all nine gifts of the Spirit plus begin to work in my life as they are needed. And God wants to bring you into this place. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. He wants to bring you into this place. Hallelujah. I got around some people last week, never interpret tongues in the light. And as soon as I got around them, the gift of interpretation in tongues hit them. So one person wrote down what he heard in the Spirit. Boy, it was accurate. It was accurate. You just got to get relaxed, people. I don't know what it is that you need to do, but you need to relax, or something you need to repent about, some attitude or some problem that's kept you connected from that which the Holy Ghost is supplying. Because the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every person right now, everybody who is connected, that is. You know, I've really felt impressed a couple of weeks ago to share with you how that William Branham, though he was the greatest miracle worker of the 20th century, showed forth the power and the glory of God on a scale that nobody had seen in modern times. I mean, we're not talking about he said he did it and there was no eyewitnesses. I'm telling you right now, there's a lot of people that say they do things in God and there's no eyewitnesses. I'm telling you right now, I pray that you'll do this too. Man, the first time God ever uses me to raise the dead that I know about, I'm going to gather as many eyewitnesses as I can. The person that got raised from the dead, deposition. They're going to go into a deposition. There's going to be the eyewitnesses. There's going to be the recordings of it. It's going to be plastered all over the website. It's going to be plenty of I'm going to give everybody ample enough proof to be able to see, yes, that truly happened. And here's their names and their telephone numbers to call them up and ask them about it. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Because I'm telling you right now, there's so many people saying so many things, and you go looking for, well, where's the proof? And you can't find none of it. I mean, my goodness, that providing the proofs wouldn't be bringing glory and honor to yourself. That'd be bringing glory and honor to the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to say, my goodness, these wonderful things are happening. Yes. Here, you can't stand against it. You'll have to call 100 people a liar. You know what I'm saying? Come on, people. God, get us ready to handle the move of the Spirit properly. But, you know, with William Branham, he was right here in the good old United States of America. He's got thousands of people in the meeting, you know, watching the person who's paralyzed from their neck down get up and walk around. I mean, my goodness gracious, and before that, he already had their name and address already on a card. I mean, there were so many proofs and evidences of it. And then all the raising of the dead. I mean, there were eyewitnesses. There were people that could be go into a court of law and swear before God, I watched it. Then there was the boy that was raised from the dead who could say, I was hit by a car and I was killed. And there was the police officer who was attending him while the coroner was on his way arriving to the. I mean, there's witnesses, and it was all put together and it was all documented, and praise God for that. Listen to this. This is my point. As soon as people begin to get all, you know, into a debate, because see, Gordon Lindsay, who was really leading up the Voice of Healing at the time, and really kind of a businessman and helped to be a spokesman and a organizer of what we call the Healing Revival. He told William Brown, he said, just give people a testimony, a simple testimony, and just tell them about how Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and how he's the healer, and how that you've been anointed of the Holy Ghost, and share about how God visited you, and leave it there. Don't tell them don't start preaching and telling them about what you believe. Because if you do, they're going to get all bent out of shape. Well, what happened, as long as William Branham was just teaching, you know, just giving a testimony about how the angel of the Lord appeared to him, you know, about the visitations of the Lord Jesus to him, and, you know, about how good God is and how Jesus is saying us today forever and how he's here to prove himself tonight. Everybody was there, and the miracles were flowing in the most amazing way, verifiable, provable by all the great men of God of the day. Okay? But as soon as people started finding out that he was Jesus, Pentecostal Jesus only, that believed that you had to be baptized in the name of Jesus only and speak in tongues as a proof that you're saved, as soon as he started telling about the two Adams in the garden, as soon as he started declaring his doctrine about spiritual Babylon and that much of denominationalism was daughters of the whore, the miracle power was still there. The miracle power was still there. But everybody was cut off now because they disagreed. Because they were now disagreement is not so bad until you enter into strife over it, you see. See, disagreement to say, now, dear brother, I love you, but I disagree with you on that, but go ahead. I recognize the anointing in your life and the ministry in your life, and you're not going to get anything bad coming out of my mouth. What happens is people go and they immediately go, they immediately go sharing how this person is wrong and off and can't believe it, and they must be, you know, a false prophet, and, you know, because why? Because they don't agree with your doctrine. They're a false prophet. Did you know that was the definition of a false prophet? Someone who does not agree with you. Or forgive me. Someone that you do not agree with. That's a false prophet. Regardless of what God has to say. Hello. And now you have to examine yourself. Are there things that you've bought into? Are there things that you've said? Are there things that you've participated with that are absolutely on you right now and keeping you cut off from a flow of the anointing that otherwise would be in your life? Listen, I'm telling you right now, you can't wrongly touch the anointing. You can't do that. You can't shove on the anointing. You cannot do it. You're not going to fall down dead as they did in the past, but there's going to be a repercussion on it spiritually. You can't steady the ark. You can't say, well, listen, you know what? I need to bring balance to this thing. Hey, listen, God the Holy Ghost just got finished talking, and you're going to balance it? Well, I'm going to tell you, it ain't going to work out for you. You don't need to bring balance. You're going to fall down dead. spiritually, it's going to have a deadly impact upon your life. And you just got to come to grips with the reality of these things. You got to learn how to behave yourself properly in these holy and sacred things of God. And the fundamental core of doing that is how you learn to just yield to the Holy Spirit and let Him just so fill you with love, where you're so overwhelmed with love that love keeps a watch on your mouth and keeps the door of your lips. That love overwhelms you so that you speak no guile, that you don't have all these accusations, or you don't have all these slanders, you don't have all your opinions about what you think it should look like. Because once you sit at the right hand of the Majesty on high, then please tell me what it looks like. Hello. You know what? You know the people that know how much it looked like the most? The people that are most in their minds and thinking the most accurate, they're certain that they know what the manifestation of the Holy Ghost and the power of God and the Word of God should look like? The people who read the Bible the less. Read the Bible the least. Those who have actually done the least in the kingdom of God with whatever anointing they supposedly have. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Because I'm going to tell you right now, the anointing is going to teach you to really honor the anointing. Are you listening to me? The anointing is going to teach you to dwell in Jesus Christ. Huh? And that's dwelling in love and walking in love. That's what the anointing is going to teach you, how to lay down your life for the brethren on a scale that Jesus revealed to us, okay? Jesus is the model. He's the end of all argument. He's both son, servant, and friend. Somebody said, oh, you know, we're not servants anymore, we're sons. Hey, you're not servants in that kind of definition that Paul gave in Galatians chapter 4, that is really on the outside and not part of the family, but you are still a servant, because Christ Jesus always remained a servant as a son. You are a servant now of God to obey God, to live under a sovereign rule, to carry out His will and purposes for life. And you a friend too. Hallelujah. 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 And it's different from what Jesus said. I don't call you servants anymore, but friends. Because He's talking now to not those people who are not part of the family, but for those people who are family. So you're no longer on the outside. You're intimately in, on the inside. Even as I called Abraham a friend after he came to a place of complete conformity to my will. I'm telling you, that's where you're at right now. I brought you all the way by an act and a work of a miracle. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. I wanted to say this. You know, at the beginning of this meeting here tonight, there was an individual in here manifesting some pretty foul things. Okay? And it was not so much that, I can handle that if it's coming from a person who doesn't know the Lord. But when a person is sitting and defying things, call themselves a Christian, and believe that they're speaking and thinking, as it were, out of the mind of the Spirit, that is something that has to be shut down, okay? That's why I had to open up the meeting tonight as I did. I had to engage with that thing, because that thing would stop the flow of what God the Holy Ghost wants to do. Now, everybody has an opportunity and an option to repent while that's going down. But sometimes people don't, and this person didn't. They walked out. The person walked out. And I just want you to understand, I am all about giving myself to seeing those things that Father is earnestly and desperately wanting to see take place in this earth right now. Understand, more than likely, Hillary Clinton will be the next president of the United States of America. You just have to understand it. You have to understand it. Don't give me all of that nonsense. You have to understand it. The Christian movement has already taken a liberal and a progressive position when it comes to God. Thus, the spiritual leads the way of that which is going to be revealed within the framework of government. Thus, a liberal progressive president is certainly on the scene. I'm sorry to tell you, dear people, but we are in perilous times. We crossed a road. We went to a crossroads with God, and we made a decision not to go with Him, but to go in another direction. And I'm saying, first and foremost, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ did that.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
You can have her or Bernie Sanders. It's either one or the other. It's pretty much how it's going to go down. I'm sorry. Somebody said, oh, you're prophesying. No, I'm not prophesying. I'm declaring to you the spiritual condition that we now are faced with. We are now living in a society, you know, do you remember back when you were in school? If you didn't really write what, especially in college, if you didn't write out what the professor believed, you're going to get a bad grade. You're going to have to agree with the professor. Now we have extreme liberal socialist kind of people who are running the academics of our universities, and they are centers of re-education. And the re-education is a liberal progressive movement. My goodness, I'm going to tell you, the Obama administration advanced that greatly. Now, all the time, the church has abdicated because the church integrated darkness into it. Church allowed the rebellion to rule it. The church had more Barabbases than they had Jesuses. They had replacements for Jesus. You hear what I'm saying? They were willing to agree with a lie that brought them into bondage. And there are people in here tonight, you have not yet come to the place where you can recognize where you're being influenced by a demonic spirit and making decisions out of the influence of a demonic spirit, and thus making wrong decisions that are holding you in prison and keeping you from moving forward with God. And he comes subtly, and he comes with great deception, and it just becomes a part of that which is normal, a part of your processes of thinking. And you're going to have to stop that. You're going to have to get yourself in the Word of God. You're going to have to learn to live by the Word of God. I mean, I'm telling you, I didn't start memorizing verses of Scripture because I wanted to impress people. I didn't start memorizing chapters of the Bible because I wanted to impress people. I did not start memorizing books of the Bible because I wanted to impress people. I started memorizing this wonderful Word of God and devouring it because I was passionate about living in the mind of Christ. I was passionate about having the mind of Christ. It wasn't some esoteric event that would happen because I got spiritual enough. It was an event the Father had given to me as a gift, and all I had to do was participate with it, desire the sincere milk of the Word so I may grow thereby. Now I begin to live by the Word instead of living by bread alone. I mean, it hit me. I was struck by the reality of it. Now I recognize it. You know, a preacher said to me the other day, and I was so honored by it. He said, "Man, you don't even have your own opinion. You always take it back to the Word." Well, thank you very much. I want to just take it back to the Word. I process. You ask me something, and I'll start processing. You watch me process. If you live around me, this particular preacher has known me for a number of years. And I'll start processing. I don't care if it's and asking me, one of the kids asking me, I don't care who it is asking me, I'm going to process based upon what the Word of God says. That's how my processes of thought works. I want to live by His Word. I want to walk in this wonderful realm in which the deceiver cannot lead me into a lie. I want to walk in the truth. You should know the truth, and the truth shall liberate you. Jesus said, "My Word is truth." And not only that, I'm going to send you the Spirit of truth so He can guide you into all the truth of the Word. And I'm going to live in that, because that's not going to happen by accident. That's not going to happen just because I showed up to church on Sunday. That's not going to happen just because I call myself a Christian. It's not going to happen just because I responded to an altar call. It happens because every single day I am committed to be the servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to obey God. I want to do the Father's will. I want everything that heaven has for me. I don't want to be a part of the slavery that demon powers would try to impose upon me by me literally taking in and responding to just one lie. If Jesus would have responded to just one lie of Satan, it would all have been lost. Why? Because it contaminates the whole thing, and it resulted in an entirely different outcome than Father had purposed. It's not all lost if we make the wrong decision, but the bottom line of it is it has the same kind of a consequence. Praise God, we can repent. But what happens when you become, by practice, you become a part of this, making these wrong decisions, making these decisions out of the mind of men. Just say mind of men. Because I'm going to tell you right now, if I get you to agree with mind of men, I'll prove to you there's the mind of the devil. Huh? Yeah. Because Satan is a master of his craft, and he is the author and the creator of the cultures and the societies of men. He is the god of this world. He's the prince of the power of the atmosphere. He influences the thoughts of men. They are like fiery darts that he throws. And only the shield of faith, only the Word of God, only this place of being hidden in Christ Jesus can defend you against such insults and such influence. True. Dear people, so many people have opened up their lives not only to the influences, the subtle suggestions of Satan, but also they've opened up their lives to all kinds of influences through the things that they allow in their lives physically. their relationships with people, the kind of music they watch, the kind of television programs they watch, the kinds of things that they allow their mind to be entertained by, to be captivated by. Listen, movie makers are masters of their craft, and they captivate your mind and hold your mind in lock to put things in your mind, to hold things in your mind. You better be careful what you sit down and decide, I'm going to sit here and I'm going to engage in and I'm going to watch. I have watched the new Noah at least a dozen times, but just the first part of it, because I can't tolerate the last part of it. I watch it over and again going, where are people's heads at? First and foremost, what is going on there, just to let you know, that is Jewish tradition. Most of that is Jewish tradition. It's in the Mishnah, okay? That's Jewish tradition. That isn't coming from a Christian perspective. This Jewish, that is Jewish tradition. It's not Torah. It's what we call Talmud or Gemara or Mishretic tradition. And I'm just looking at the influence there and think, I contemplate how that, in contrast and comparing it to when the church was active, you know, how the church really influenced more the decision-making as the experts. We've lost our seat of expertise. We've lost our legitimacy. The light isn't shining anymore. The salt isn't salty anymore. Why? Because it was mixed with all these other things that belong to the world. There were subtle lies of compromise that were taken in, and it changed our direction. And now we, like sheep, follow a half-truth. And at best, a 90% truth with a 10% lie. But the bottom line of it is, it still ends up lying. And so we don't end up participating with what Father wants in His church. Father wants the manifestation of the Holy Ghost happening in His church. First and foremost, the presence of it, to when we come together, that we all baptized by one Spirit down into one body, where His Spirit comes upon us, and we all overwhelmed with the divine glory of His presence. Hallelujah. That no man can emotionalize or make up or dramatize or create out of some human form. It's just a supernatural event of divine glory. I come to the meeting, I have it. I look around going, what's going on? How many people have what God put in the midst of the church? I got it. I'm a Mosa Taranaya and the Fatosarinkai on a Mosiki Tapona that produces the interpretation of it is there, that produces the doctrine and the prophecy is there. The songs, I'm singing in the Holy Ghost, hallelujah. I'm in and out. I'm trying to sing in English and participate, but I get caught away in a spiritual song too. And then all of a sudden, I'll bust out and I'll start singing a new song as well. And I'm going, come on, man, how long does this have to be modeled? And yet it's not even modeled by many. But where it is modeled, it's just there's so much division. There's so many people turned to their own will, living. See, here's what goes down. If you live to do your own will, it's especially going to be manifested in the church. Because in the church, Father's going to have it just like it is. He's not going to allow pretending. He's not going to allow. Everything is going to be revealed for what it is. You hear me? Yes. You start walking in the Spirit and living by the Spirit. You start being filled with the Spirit. You start hungering and thirsting. As the word that Ruth Anna gave the day that I posted, you dust off the gifts of the Spirit, the precious gifts of the Spirit that God has given the church that you just let be secondary in your life and just be on the shelf. Oh, yeah, that gift of the Spirit. Oh, yeah. You heard what the Holy Spirit said to you on Sunday? Hey, Sunday night? Was it a reality Monday? Was it a reality Tuesday? Was it burning in your spirit this morning when you woke up? If not, then you're going to have to understand there's something going on in your life where you're being hearers and not doers. There's something going on, something's going down in your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ where you've allowed replacements in your life and you didn't realize it. Listen, religion's not good enough with God. Jesus died at Calvary for us to have a relationship. Listen, just being a part of what's going on in the kingdom of God is not good enough. Jesus Christ rose again that we might be one with Him. You must hear what I'm saying, because I'm going to tell you right now, very soon, you are going to find yourself in the midst of this crisis that is coming down on this nation. I don't know that there's any turning back. I don't know that there's any turning back. Are you listening to me? I don't know that there's any turning back economically. I don't know that there's any turning back from what? I mean, come on, think about it. Putin's becoming the hero for the millennials. Hello. Hello. He's making a stand because there's no other strong leader who knows what he believes in making a stand. Because most people would say, wait, that's wrong, and you're telling me that that's okay? And that's right, and you're telling me that you're not so sure? But here's this guy over here. He's got a clear definition of what's right and what's wrong. Although he doesn't believe it, he's spouting it. Listen to me. Uh-oh. And what happened? The church has abdicated because we don't know what's right and what's wrong. We got drinking. We got alcohol. We got drugs going on in the midst of the church. We got all kinds of compromise. People are offended by revival. They offended by the Holy Ghost. They offended by the gifts of the Spirit. They offended by God. They're trying to explain away. Hell, oh, well, listen, God doesn't really mean that. And oh, you got to understand, it's okay. It was a different kind of a God back there in the Old Testament when he had everybody killed. He's different now. People offended by God. They're offended. They're offended by hell. They're offended by everything that God represents. They're offended by his absolutes. What? Look, it's what's going on in the populous society of the church. It's what makes big churches. Big churches are not made by great preaching. They're made by great musicians. Ask anybody who's got a big church. I've interviewed them. What made your church big? Great musician. We had great music. Great music. And we open our arms really broadly to not speak offensive messages. And all the correction we left in the small group meetings, but unfortunately nobody in the small group meetings were willing to be correctors. And those that did got fired. And those that stood up for some truth and stood up for some powerful position in the Word of God, no one came to their church group meetings anymore. And said the pastor reorganized that one. And they either left or got assimilated. No, you think I'm telling you a story, or you think I'm making this up. You think I'm exaggerating. You think it's not touching you. You think you're unaffected by it. I tell you, you're infected. You got the virus, but I got the cure. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The cure is the Word of God. Coming into a place of obeying the Word of God, where you hunger and thirst after the Word of God, where the Word of God becomes very important to you. People live whole days without the Word of God in their life. How can you do that? You have other interests. You have substitute relationship with God by earthly interests. You listen to me. You have substitute earthly relationships, earthly interests with a relationship with God. I came from the church. I remember the old women in the church. The older ladies in the church and the older men in the church, the adults in the church so full of the Holy Ghost. I remember going into their houses or having them come to our houses to visit them. And man, when they went in the bedroom to pray, they filled the whole house with the sound of their voice. Huh? And it was something they did every day, but now it's religious. I remember the people who were constantly carrying a Bible around and had the Word of God there. And the Word of God was superior to everything else. And Bible reading at every table, every time you sit down to eat. And Bible reading and prayer before you went to bed at night was something that was the standard. It was the way that things went down. The hunger for the Word was there. And out of that, you saw people that had tongues and interpretation of tongues, that had the gift of wisdom and the ability to speak on behalf of the Lord. And the church was a powerful force within the framework of the culture and society. And out of that glorious church, God raised up great men of power and great men of faith. And they were as deliverers on Mount Zion that Obadiah speaks of. They were. And the Lord's going to do it again. Yeah. Because the deliverers on Mount Zion, the Messiahs on Mount Zion, isn't just for the millennial reign. There's many things in the Word of God in the Old Testament that looks like it's for the millennial reign only, but it is also for the church age as well. Amen. God raises up deliverers. He raises up people that have a great anointing to shout it out, and people shake. Father recently put a word in my mouth and a prayer. Oh God, let your anointing, let the fire of your presence be upon me so strong that people shake like leaves in the wind. Shake like leaves on the tree when wind is blowing. I'm going after these things in God. Hey, if you purify yourself, even as he is pure, If you'll purge yourself from these things, you'll be prepared unto every good work, meet for the master's use. It's about time somebody comes out from among them. Be separate, says God. Then I will receive you, and I'll be your God, and you'll be my people. It's about time people quit playing these games on God's sacred and holy things. Listen to me. It's about time the church turned back. Hallelujah. Somebody said, we want revival. Well, first you've got to turn back. You have to turn back first. You have to turn back. You have to turn unto God. You have to return to Him. Then you can have revival. Because revival is where we now begin to live in the things that God had already had, always has had for us. Huh? Where the where you look out on the people's faces and there's more than 10 or 15, there's more than 30 or 40% of the people whose faces are fiery red with the anointing and their bellies full of a word right from heaven. Instead of everybody sitting there like, huh? Firecrackers that were duds. We lit them up, but it just went, pfft. Are you listening to me? And you're supposed to be kegs of dynamite, you know what I'm saying? Getting lit with just a little bit of fire. You don't need no big old blazing torch over here. Huh? You don't need no giant bonfire. You don't need the sun to come down. You just need a little teeny bit of a spark to get that fuse lit. Hallelujah. Just the slightest little spark of His presence. Boom! The explosions of God go off in your life. Here's what I know. I know this church is dedicated to this. I know this church is consecrated to this. This is why the Lord keeps saying He's going to continue to say it till you get it right. Yeah. Don't blame it on God. Blame it on yourself. Go look in the mirror and say it's your fault. Amen. It's about time you get right. It's about time you start walking with God. It's time about time you make God's will more important than your will. It's about time you make the things of heaven more important than the things of hell. It's about time you make things of the Holy Spirit more wonderful and more pleasurable than the things of demon spirits. It's about time you start dividing between the light and the darkness, between the truth and the lie, between the good and the evil, between the holy and the sacred and the profane and the common. It's about time. That's wisdom. It's just wisdom. That's all. That's somebody who's taken a hold of God's word, who's the Spirit of the Lord, and now is able to work in their life just on a little bit, little level. Amen. Entry level. Hallelujah. Praise God. The gifts that God has given us. He's given us the gift of holiness. He's given us the gift of righteousness. And all we got to do is be willing to be developed in it. He's given it to us. It's a gift. It's a gift. It's ours. Now all we got to do is be so excited about it that we want to learn. We want to walk. We want to grow. We want to mature. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me. When the move of God takes place, I'll be right at ground zero. I'm going to tell you right now, when the power of God, when God comes sovereignly, wait, come on now. When God comes sovereignly, see, I got boldness. I come before the presence without any guilty conscience. I come with no condemnation. I get to walk in boldly. That's why I can talk like this. You may keep your mouth shut and think you're not worthy, but I'm going to tell you right now, if you take a hold of the blood of Jesus Christ and believe in the name and the work of divine grace, you'll be bold too. You can come with all boldness into the throne and say, I'm going to be right there too. I'm going to be, when God comes, as he when he comes, he moves sovereignly. God's always moving, but he has sovereign moves on those that are always allowing him to move. You listen to me. Those who are always allowing the moving of the Spirit of God in their life, God comes sovereignly and does things that shuts everybody down. Ha ha ha. Hallelujah. And he comes. Hosea 6 verse 3 said this. He said, and then we'll know those who passionately pursue the Lord, for he shall come to them as the early and the latter rain. See, when he comes as the early and the latter rain, there's a lot of people going, I don't believe that that's God. They were not passionately pursuing the Lord. We know that they weren't passionately pursuing the Lord because he came sovereignly and they were wondering if it was the devil or not. They were wondering if he was demon-possessed or not. They were saying he did what he did by the power of Beelzebub. They said, my spirit doesn't bear witness with what's going on. He's talking down to people and being too harsh. Somebody said, what would Jesus do? Well, making a whip and running people out of the church is one of the options.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's one of the possibilities. Let me put it that way to you. You listen to me. What would Jesus do? Hallelujah. I can tell you a lot more because I read the Bible. I read it all the time, so I won't forget it. Praise God. These things are fresh in my mind and in my spirit.
Yes,
Hallelujah. That way I can live by the word of God. I'm constantly stirring myself up by putting myself in remembrance of these things. Peter says, as long as I'm in this tabernacle, I will stir you up by putting you in remembrance of these things. Well, praise God, I can stir my own self up by putting my own self in remembrance of these things, because I get to read what he wrote down while he was in his tabernacle. Yeah. Earthly one, he's in a heavenly tabernacle now, waiting for the resurrection of the dead. Amen. Waiting for his body to come up out of the grave. Ooh, he's got a building made of the Lord, a heavenly tabernacle. Hallelujah. His body has been dissolved. Hallelujah. But he had a building prepared of the Lord in the heavens, waiting for his earthly body to be raised up from the dead again. Hallelujah. To be just like the resurrected body of Jesus Christ, our Savior, the eternal God, who is forever going to bear about this body that he was incarnated into, with nail-scarred hands, a nail-scarred feet, and a scarred back from the whipping post, and a brow scarred by thorns for our salvation. So we'll look at him forever and see that which purchased our salvation. Ooh, I want to see it now. I want to see it now. Hallelujah. Why? Because I want my emotions moved more deeply by what he is doing and what he's done for me, so that my emotions aren't available for anything else. I want my passions more deeply moved by who he is and what he's doing, that my passions aren't available for anything else. I want my appetites and my attitudes to be so consumed by the fire of his presence that it's not available for any other kind of fire. Come on now, listen to me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so do you. And it's simple commitments. Where Saturday isn't, it's all about you. Saturday sometimes about fasting and praying, getting on your face before the Lord and spending the whole day in the Word. Huh? Hallelujah. Where all your afternoons, all your evenings when you get off of work, isn't just all about you and what you want to do for you. Huh? It's about you getting on your face before the Lord and opening up the Word and getting in the Scripture. I never told my kids, go read the Bible. They saw Dad reading the Bible. They went and did it. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
They watch mom and dad. You walk into my house, you see Bibles opened all over the place. Ann leaves a trail of Bibles everywhere she goes. She's my walking reference. I mean, especially when I'm, you know, when we're out traveling other places, I get real close to her because she's going to lips, to me the verse of scripture that I missed, or the one she knows, the one I don't really know, because she can see the look in my eyes, so she's already getting me ready so that I can get it right. She's walking Bible reference. Hallelujah. 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 She's the kind of person who wants to go read the Word of God rather than watch TV. She's no interest. She's captivated. Huh? She was sitting by a person the other day on the airplane, and the person, she's got her Bible open. The person looked over and said, oh, I've been there, done that. Oh, that's a good book to read. And Ann didn't say nothing. She wasn't impressed to say anything to her. She just kept on reading. Huh? But reality of it is, she's read it so many times, and it just keeps getting better every time. Amen. And it does, because every time you read it, now you're ready now to read again and get a little bit more this time. When we're finished delivering to you all of his precepts, hallelujah, and the whole counsel of God, you know what we're going to do? I'm going to start again. Yes. Let's start all over. We'll start right back at the beginning. Until you start making things more important to you. See, I want to challenge you tonight about making earthly things more important to you than heavenly things. Because all that's going to be turned against you is evidence that your heart was never in this. Hello. Even if it weren't. I mean, just think about the embarrassment and the shame upon your life. When you stand before his presence and you look at him face to face and you have to deal with the reality, because all the truth and all that you did immediately flashed before you, it's there. You think, I made my earthly interest a greater priority than you. How can you even stand? How would you even be able to stand? You tell me, how would you be able to stand in his presence that way? Are you listening to me? Yeah. I'm talking to you tonight about what Father wants in his house. And what Father wants in his house is going to come as a direct result of what you allow in your life. Father's will being performed in his house through you is a direct result and a direct product of how much you're willing to do the will of the Father in your own individual life. How important it is when you're ready to stand up and defend yourself. But the Lord says, no, you bless. You make peace. You be a peacemaker. You represent me. You show kindness and grace and mercy. You show gentleness and goodness. And the Word of God rules you, and the Spirit of God rules you so much that it's bigger than some emotion that belongs to the human realm of pride and arrogance. Huh? Because you've already practiced denying yourself long enough to recognize that you've got to shut that down. You don't allow that. Because the Word of God rules you, you see? Yes. And with the Word of God ruling you, and you're now going to live to do the will of the Father. When you do the will of the Father, you're not doing your own will anymore. So when you consecrate your life to do the will of the Father, hey, the will, your own will is now so deprioritized that it shouldn't even be allowed as one of the options. But yet it comes, and you're ready to defend yourself, and your arrogance and your self-interest and your self-preservation, your fight-or-flight mode kicks in. Huh? And you haven't read the Bible for 2 weeks. You're going to be all in on you. I'm just saying. His word is spirit and life. It's just not black ink on white paper. It's not. People want to make preaching something that is less than what Father wants for our lives. It's so valuable. It's so essential. It's so important. He chose the foolishness of preaching to declare and reveal the power of God. People want to make somehow. I actually had a person tell me, a preacher tell me. He said he grew up around people. This is just over the past 15 years. Young preacher. So grew up around people that what they saw among Christians that read the Bible was nothing that looked like Jesus. So they decided that reading the Bible wasn't going to get you anywhere. Because look at them. So all of a sudden, reading the Bible became a liability to being like Jesus. Hello. There's a lot of people watching me by web right now or by YouTube. You're nodding your head because you know that. You've been influenced by the same thing. It's in the atmosphere. Huh? So show me, and then all of a sudden somebody comes along who is reading the Bible, who is giving themselves the Bible, and all of a sudden now they see someone who's, wait a minute, I want to get where you're at in God. How did you get your thoughts lined up with the Word of God like that? By reading the Bible. Because His Word is spirit and life. It's living and powerful. And when you believe it, listen, when you believe that, you're like, what? Where? Where is it? Where is it living and powerful? From Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. Listen, it's living, it's powerful, man. When you get that, I mean, you've got the solution, you've got the cure, you've got the remedy. I mean, praise God for godly parents. I'd go to my mother and said, Mom, can I sleep with you, little guy? Can I sleep with you? I had a bad dream. Here, son, take the Bible, put it under your pillow. You'll sleep great from here on in. I learned to get comforted by the Bible at a very young age. I took Mama's Bible into the bedroom. I put it on my pillow, lay down on the pillow. And sure enough, it worked. Comforted by the Word. To be strengthened by the Word. To let the Word of Christ dwell in me. The Word of Christ will not dwell in me unless I let the Word of God dwell in me. There will not be any utterance word of the Holy Ghost that is right out of the Spirit of Jesus. I'm representing Jesus. I'm standing in His place. I'm in Him and He's in me. That's not going to be there unless His Word is there. Thy your Word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. I write unto you, young men, because the Word abides in you and you're strong because of it. And you defeated the wicked one at every point. People want to try to defeat Satan. They want to understand how that if they do these things, they will never even stumble. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 1. Somebody was reading that one day and somebody said, man, I really want to understand how to do that. I want to really understand what it means, how I can step into that place where I'll never stumble. I said, well, it's just right here, man. What are you talking about? You really earnestly want to get to that place where you never stumble? Yeah. Well, read this. Newsflash, it's right here, verses 4 to 10. First, 2 Peter chapter 1. Give all attendance to making your calling and election sure. Be diligent about all these things that belong to the character and the nature of God. People walk around with bad attitudes and feel good about it. I'm not kidding you. And you know I'm not, because you've been participating with such things. Instead of being broken about it, Lord, I'm dishonoring you. I'm embarrassing the cross instead of embracing it. I don't know how it'd be possible for you to be the same after listening to this kind of preaching. I don't even know how it's possible for you to continue on like you are under this kind of an anointing. I have no idea how people can develop such brazenness and resistance against God the Holy Ghost. How that you could possibly live with yourself another day when all of a sudden, you know, when you had an encounter with God like you're having right now at this moment in time, whether you realize it or not. Pharisees didn't realize they were having an encounter with God. Whether you're here watching by web or on YouTube, they said they thought it was just another devil. And worse than anything else they'd ever heard. Oh, dear people, if you just open up your heart just a little bit to the living God, if you just throw away that old beggar's garment, just quit living your own life. You vowed to God that you didn't live no anymore. You said we understood that if Christ died for all, then all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves. Quit lying and start doing what God told you to do, what you promised God you would do when he saved you and redeemed you with his own blood, with his own life. Don't lie against the truth. Living for yourself and saying you God's servant, you God's person, you the example. Get yourself over to the fire of the Holy Ghost because that's what God demands. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. I just thought of something. On Friday night after the School of Spirit, where everybody wants to be involved in children's ministry. We're going to have a meeting right after the School of Spirit. Everybody wants to be involved in children's ministry. We want to come. Be quiet, because once again, this really comes back to this whole, you know, importance. I know if you can go in and you can grab a hold of orphans, you can change a nation through orphans. If you set up orphanages properly and they raised in the power of God, the Holy Ghost, and they got good models and examples. My goodness, if I did that and wasn't so adamant and passionate about a continual advancement of and maturation of ministry to children in this church, boy, would I ever be a loser. You know what I'm saying? Would I ever be stupid? Brainless, huh? I want you to recognize you're going to come with a passion to say, I am going to be a cut above everybody else in the anointing. I am going to be a person that gives myself to the Word of God more than anyone else. I'm going to be a person that gives myself to prayer more than anyone else, so that the Spirit of the Lord may begin to be manifested through my life. Hallelujah. Because I'm telling you right now, you can talk all you want, but people are going to watch what you do. Children do not learn how to speak, by reading the dictionary.
Amen.
Children don't learn how to speak by, you know, some computer program that compares what they said to, you know, the way you're properly supposed to say it. They learn how to speak by watching their parents act. That's how they learn how to form words. That's how they learn how to form behavior. That's how they learn how to form attitude. That's how they learn how to form response. That's how they learn how to form every dimension of character within the behavior spiritually and naturally, which is all basic, which all spiritually just manifests in different ways. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I'm telling you right now, I'm going to be watching you. If you're not on fire in the meetings and you in one children's ministry, I'm going to come have a talk with you and see if we can work it out. If we can't work it out, somebody else is going to have to take your place. Because I know the kids are watching you. You hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
I know what the enemy does. You listen, I'm just going to tell you, I'm preparing. I want to prepare. I want to prepare so that God the Holy Ghost can breathe on those things that we're doing. The Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, if you're cultivating the fruit that I'm cultivating when I come and I move sovereignly, if you're doing what I'm doing, then I'll take that and I'll bless it and I'll use it in a greater dimension. And when we're talking about that, we're talking about bringing in the lost. Cultivating the wrong fruit, doing the wrong thing, participating in the wrong thing, not what Father wants, and then all of a sudden the lost came in, and they got to try to be a part of that. Give me a break. I'm not interested in my ideas. I'm not interested in your ideas. I'm interested in God's ideas. I understand how he did it.
Amen.
Okay? I understand how he poured out his Spirit upon all flesh. I understand how the Holy Ghost moves and how that works. I understand what real, true hunger and thirst for God is. I understand what response to the Holy Spirit is. I understand that. Not only because I've read it in the Word of God, but because I have participated with the moving of God in these things. Hallelujah. And forcing people how to pray and forcing people how to do this and forcing people how to do that. It's not about any kind of human manipulation or human control. It's about a leadership, and it's about an anointing, and it's about a consistency, and it's about a faithfulness, and it's about always reaching to a greater depth in God. And it's always reaching to a greater compassion in the Spirit. Hallelujah. What does Father want in this church? Father wants Jesus to be seen by the operation of the Holy Ghost in each one of our individual lives.
Amen.
That's what he wants. You're going to have to give you, you said you no longer live. It's Christ Jesus that lives. We thus judge that if one died for all are dead, not just Paul.
Right.
Amen.
That we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves, but live unto him who rose and who died and rose again. Now, when that becomes a living reality and a practical reality and something that's in your heart, so big that when you wake up in the morning, you say, Holy Spirit, I haven't got the capacity within my own ability and within my own understanding to live out such a glorious life. I yield myself completely over to you. Take charge of me. Make me sensitive to your leadership, lest I should forget, lest I should for one moment not remember who you are and be aware of your presence and allow some evil thing to begin to work against me or in me. You hear what I'm saying? It is a wonderful, beautiful graduation, if you would, and promotion to be continually aware of the presence of the Lord. And in that, a maturation comes of a greater revelation of the Father. And in that, see that relationship begins to produce a supernatural outworking of the Spirit, of the Holy Ghost, not only in the realms of the dimension of our character and our nature, but also in the manifestation of the power gifts, especially faith. And all faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm believing, God, that we'll be able to partner with different things that opportunities that we have over this next year in 2016 to see a host of children come into the ministry.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And people who are in the ministry, in children's ministry, dedicated to taking care of them and bringing them in.
Amen.
This showing up to do whatever it is you're going to do ain't going to work.
Amen.
You have to labor in the ministry.
Yeah.
You have to be committed to growing the ministry. It's about reaching the lost. Huh? Come on now. Hallelujah. And you know, we, at one point in time, you know, we really got into this, I really got into this and led the charge in it, and we had over 2,000 kids inside of 3-4 months and come to the ministry, go and pick them up with buses. Had, on average, around 150, 200 kids in the meetings. It was a little bit more too much to handle because we didn't have the human resources that we needed, you know. So I learned a lot about it. I learned about growth in it, you know, how to be more mindful of the way you develop that. But I just want to go after it again. I'm earnest to go after it again.
Amen.
See what the Lord will do. And I'm earnest to see you so begin to participate with God in His church. You begin to let God, the Holy Ghost, do through you what He wants to do. Just begin to read these things about your responsibility to be here, not sad of a sad countenance and overwhelmed by their problems and circumstances, but joyful. Somebody's done nothing to be joyful about. I'd like for you to respond to the invitation tonight to accept Jesus Christ in your life, to have your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, to have a new whole beginning, whole new beginning in God. Then you'll have something to be happy about and joyful about from here on in. And if you don't, it will be an all-consuming joy and happy. Hallelujah. And then if it ever comes a time that some little, you know, earthly issue trumps that and becomes bigger, then we'll just have you rededicate your life again to Jesus and come back to the Lord and renew your first love. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God, until the point you find out that, man, I can walk this straight and the narrow. Hallelujah. I can live in this glorious place in God.
Amen.
And I love this life that He's given me. And I'm just happy all the time. Hallelujah. When you walk in the anointing, you exceeding glad even in the tribulation. You exceeding glad even in the hard time.
Amen.
I mean, we just blessed coming in and blessed going out. You can't walk in the presence of the Lord and not be blessed. Hallelujah. 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 By this time, I figured that I have most people happy and already flowing in the anointing. But I said, I need to spend at least another 3-4 hours. At this rate, unless all of a sudden some exponential response is going to kick in. You know what I'm saying? I'm just looking at where we were, where we've come from, and how what you've done in response to God. Are you with me? I want you to lay hold on to God. I want you to know God's here. God is here. I want you to let God be God. I want you to recognize the Holy Ghost is here. I want you to recognize God, the Holy Ghost, is talking to you, not to someone else, not to someone that looks like you. He's talking to you. You're not here proxy for somebody else who needs this. You're here for you. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. I want you to imagine with me. I'm getting ready to close, but there's good imagination, there's bad imagination. The only good imagination is when you read the Word of God and you imagine yourself in that. You imagine yourself living out the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man. You imagine the power of God moving through your life in such a way that whole people, groups are transformed by the power of God the way they were through Paul's life. You know, you just begin to imagine the ministry of Jesus in your life, you know, where the loaves and the fishes are multiplied, you know, and the blind see and the dead hear. You begin to imagine. See, you not imagine that, you imagine something else. You imagine how much of a whatever you are. You know what I'm saying? Forget about those imaginations. The weapons of a warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down that mess. But over here, imagining the things in the Word of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Getting creative with God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hasebere de kana Messiah. And now beginning to live in that. Beginning to see those things which God described in His Word as a reality to you. To begin to see with it, with the imagination or the mind of Christ and the mind of the Spirit, that Jesus lives in you, that you the very temple of the Holy Ghost, that the cloud of God's glory is all around you, the fire of God's on your head. And then you begin to walk in it. You begin to see it. You take a glance in the mirror and you almost see it. You almost see that fire on you, you know. Woo! And you can feel His presence every day increasing more and more in your life. Because you don't allow your emotions and your passions to slip over into a place of darkness and sorrow and death. You know what you do if you begin to feel anything like that? Then the condemnation and guilt and unhappiness. You know what you do? Run to the Word. Run to the living Word that is expressed to us in His Word. Just run over there and start getting yourself some spirit and life. Start getting yourself some living, something that is living and powerful. Hallelujah. Watch the quickening Word of God. Watch God quicken you according to His Word. That means that's a bolt of life that jolts through your being so strong in God that all of a sudden you stand back up in the things that God's made you to be. Quicken me, make me alive according. Jolt me with heaven's lightning bolts according to your Word. Ha! Hallelujah. I pray you begin to imagine yourself as a member in the body of Christ. Begin to imagine the glorious church and what the glorious church is supposed to look like. I heard so many people complaining that it's not the glorious church. Well, why don't you start participating with it being the glorious church? Why don't you quit complaining about what you don't see? Get into what has been made provision, especially right here. I'm going to tell you right now, we're not shutting the Holy Ghost. I'm not ashamed of the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you right now. I'm desperate for the moving of the Holy Ghost. I tell you right now, I'm passionate about the glorious church. I'm passionate about seeing people once again literally burning with the fire of God's glory on their face, seeing the Word of God stirred in their belly so strong that love and that joy and that holy emotion is always just right there. I mean, it's hard to even preach because people are shouting you down. They're so full of the glory and the power of God. I mean, I'm telling you, I tell you, preachers, the Holy Ghost preachers make the best audience. Because they up moving around, running, jumping, shouting, screaming, standing up. You got to get them to sit down at least 15 times in the meeting. And I'd very much rather have that. And that looks like a whole much more like a glorious church where people feel and experience the presence of God than seeing people just reclining in their chair like this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, it's the time, listen, it's the time to bring forth, and it ain't going to be no passing of wind.
Amen.
Are you listening
Come
to me?
On.
That's one way to translate that.
Yeah.
At the time of bringing forth, and you're ready to be delivered, all it was a passing of wind.
Right.
It ain't gonna be that way. Ain't gonna be that way. No, we're gonna recognize what it means to be there, participating with what Father has purposed to bring forth and giving a whole being to it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now hear the word of the Lord and respond and obey. Learn how to rule your spirit and cast down those things that are contrary to holy emotions. Understand that Father has given you the capacity to be in joy, unspeakable, and full of glory all the time, and not be spotty like a cell phone and cell service. You know what I'm saying? Some, you know, off-brand cell service with a cheap... Every once in a while, you get a little bit of a signal from heaven. We don't know. Two services in the row, they're happy and full of the Holy Ghost. Now we're back into polar Christianity. Where there was a high, there's got to be a low. Are you with me? Yeah, we're not having that. I think that's why that disease had a breakout in our generation. Because where the spiritual goes, huh?
Yeah.
You with me? Break out of it.
Amen.
I'm going to live in heaven. I'm going to live in Jesus all the time. I'm going to walk in the Spirit. Hallelujah. I'm going to give myself to walk in the Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah. When I'm reminded I'm not walking in the Spirit, that's proof I'm walking in the Spirit right there. Amen. Hallelujah. Because the Lord gets hold of me real quick. Says, no, you're not living in me. You're not doing what I want you to do. You all upset. You have, those of you who don't know this, you can have 5 minutes being whatever it is you want to be, the contrary to the Word of God. But you need to get over it. And then we're going to wean you down to 30 seconds. And when you get to 30 seconds, you won't want it anymore. You can be mad and upset and feel disappointed, neglected and dejected like a loser and whatever else you want to feel, because it's all about you. It's not become all about Jesus. You've not become a slave of Jesus Christ yet. It's not about I no longer live. It's about I do live and I want to really feel it. You hear me?
Yeah.
I'm going to get after you.
Yeah.
I'm going to get after you until you don't like you and you run you off every time you see you. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Why should we want to live when we can rather live in Christ, and Christ Jesus can be the one who lives?
Amen.
To see the beauty of Him, just to have the privilege of it. Hallelujah. Too many substitutes for Jesus, and the best of the substitutes are a Barabbas. Too many substitutes for Jesus. It's time that we just go ahead and start living the life and enjoying it.
Amen. Amen.
It's time to start living in heaven.
Amen.
Start being a citizen in heaven, have your conversation in heaven, be seated in heaven. Would you like me to give you all those verses of Scripture? Because I just quoted 3 verses of Scripture. Hallelujah. I pray that the Word of God is so alive in you, so feel full of the Word. Amen. That everything about your life is a description of a living oracle. Someone's living out the Word. Thank you, Jesus. So, Father, we ask you now in Jesus' name that every person's heart who's set upon you in this place, by your mercy and your grace, that they become to understand how to participate with what you want in your church. What you're passionate about having in your church. Hallelujah. And that those who've not stepped into tongues and interpretation of tongues, which is one of the first gifts you place in the church, that they'll begin to enjoy the beauty of it. And I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, that it begin to become exercised and a fluency in their life, in their prayer times at home, and that as they give themselves to prayer, they recognize that they're just giving themselves to you, giving you an opportunity, Holy Spirit, to flow through them. As they give themselves to prayer, they're just giving they're yielding themselves to you, Holy Spirit, to begin to exercise these wonderful things that reveal the body of Christ, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, it won't just be a time as it has been for them, but from here on in, it'll be a glorious time, a heavenly time, a supernatural time, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 And that there would be with that a supply of faith to recognize that they can just begin to function in it, they can begin to flow in it, and that with that there'll be a Holy Ghost imagination. Hallelujah. And not a demonic imagination that they can't do it, that it's not real, that it's not theirs, that they got to do something to have it, but one that allows them to begin to see you right before them and recognize that this freedom of heaven will flow right through them as they begin to walk around and just prophesy while they're praying. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. May receive the Douglas. Everybody stand with me, will you? Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Porosanaha. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Father's raising up an army, not just a few, but many.
Yes.
Father is grabbing a hold of those people's hearts, and maybe many of them that will stand up in this great revival that is about to be unleashed from heaven upon the earth. Will be in many of the radical people who don't even know Jesus right now. And they're going to immediately step in like Paul did, like Cornelius' house did and others did, into a great flow of the anointing. They're just going to immediately go to heaven. They're going to immediately go to heaven. I've seen it among the youth and young adults of China and other places that are where the wind of God is blowing. They just immediately step into it without restraint. They don't even care about the things that everybody else cares about. They don't care about making money. They don't care about having a house. They don't care about having a car. They care about heaven. Hallelujah. They care about Jesus. They care about this glory. They care about the fact that once they were lost and now they're found. Once they were dead and now they're alive. Once they were blind and now they see. And I believe with all of my heart that within the ranks of the church are those people that God has, that have allowed the Holy Spirit to develop them. They've responded every time to the Word of God. I'm going to, by the help and the grace of God, I pray that you'll follow me. When I hear the Word of God, I respond to it every time. I respond to it. I don't resist God, the Holy Ghost. I don't resist His Word. I respond. I say, yes, Lord, I want that. And by your help and your grace, I'm going to do it. I don't look to myself to do it because tonight, listen to me. If you're looking to yourself, you're going to fail. You're going to fail. God's never going to honor it. It's never going to be blessed. Looking to yourself is going to be revealed by failure over and again. You know, somebody came to me one time and they said, you know, I don't know whether it's God or whether it's me. I said, are you succeeding or failing? They said, I'm failing. I said, it's you. God always succeeds. Always succeeds. And all we have to do is simply be committed that I no longer live as Christ, and now all of a sudden we can let it be God, and we can just let God do it, and we can just let Him arise and His enemies be scattered. Hallelujah. We can just let Him stand up. We can let Him produce within us His blessing. We can let God be God. We can understand it. We can understand that, you know, if the door opens, it's God. I'm going to let God be God. If the door closes, it's God. I'm going to let God be God. It doesn't matter if I'm in the field, I'm going to let God be God. Or if I'm in the mountains, I'm going to let God be God. Hallelujah. If I'm in my house, I'm going to let God be God. If I'm in the street, I'm going to let God be God. If it's a peacetime, I'm going to let God be God. If Hillary Clinton's president, I'm going to let God be God. You say, oh, we're going to pray and we're going to fast and it won't be. Well, you're going to have, your prayer and fast is going to have to result in you returning to the Lord and letting God, the Holy Ghost, take authority in His church and take authority first and foremost in your life and have authority and reign in the church. And you're going to have to get over your offense of being offended by the moving of the Spirit and offended by the things that God, the Holy Ghost, does and offended by Hill and offended by all the other doctrines that you don't like. Because God's not a humanist. Against popular opinion, God is not a humanist. Tonight, the Lord is calling us to come be with him. I am the people which the Lord has given me. This is what Jesus is saying. Tonight, we just want to step in and say, okay, Father, we've heard it so many times about how we need to prepare ourselves and make ourselves ready to just recognize that Wednesday night is a different night. It's a night of church. And if there's any day that we want to really be sensitive to hearing your Holy Spirit and being continually filled with you, it's on Wednesday and on Sundays or whatever church meeting days it has. And by God's help and grace, it will be that way for you every day. I pray that if you go to bed at night and you've not had a flow of the anointing in your life, that you will feel so much like a loser. You will feel so guilt-ridden. You'll feel like you lived your life for yourself, and it's a terrible thing that you'll get up and repent and have a move of God and then go lay back down in the bed. Because it is. I mean, to have all this made available to us and then we don't do anything with it, it's that and all that I just described and more. It's about time people quit walking around like God is dead or that God doesn't like them or that somehow the moving of the Spirit of God is for everybody else but them. And recognize you just need to get things straightened out in your life.
Amen.
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 And one thing is that you recognize that you actually have control over your smiling muscles. Some people haven't got a spiritual enough insight to recognize that they actually have control over their smile muscles. They don't know that. Some people don't realize that they actually have authority to raise their hands, to clap, to sing, to dance, to get excited.
Yeah.
You hear what I'm saying? Because we watch as people live under an oppression as though that they have no ability to smile. To be joyful in the house of the Lord. You cannot bring the praise that Father's looking for unless your heart is filled with thanksgiving. It's just a sing-along song. Listen to me. I'll say it again. It's just a sing-along song until your heart is filled with thanksgiving. That is God is not going to sovereignly come and move on you and make you be thankful. That is something you voluntarily do. Because the Word of God dwells in you. And you're thinking about what God did for you instead of what you did for you. Now, if I was thinking about what I did for me, I'd be sad too. But in thinking about what Father did for me, then I can begin to praise Him, you see? Now I can begin to praise Him. And I tell you, God the Holy Spirit will so hook up with that praise and that joy and that rejoicing that it will come stronger and stronger and stronger in your life. And it doesn't have to be erratic. You don't have to be up and down with it. You don't have to be like the waves of the sea back and forth. You don't have to be double-minded, one day in, one day out, 1 minute in, 1 minute out. You can live continually in this glory. And the decision is yours. God has already decided. The choice is yours. Father's already chosen.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hey, can I tell you something kind of in a profane way? God did more than wave a magic wand over your life and bless you that you'd be happy all the days of your life. Like the little, children's stories. God poured out His Spirit. Hallelujah. Ha 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 He created a new heart and a new spirit. Filled us with His glory. So that we can rejoice forevermore. So that we... Woo! Tonight, if you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ personally, if you've not encountered Him, the Holy Spirit wants to come to your life and introduce Him to you. God wants to radically grab a hold of you and save you from the life that you've been living. He wants to bring you into His kingdom so that you no longer live in the kingdoms of this world, in the kingdom of darkness. He will take you and He will translate you out of the kingdom of darkness, out of the power of darkness. He will deliver you and translate you in the kingdom of the dear Son. Tonight, if you've got sin in your life, if you've got things that are reoccurring sin and addiction, that's a demonic stronghold. You're not right with God. That thing has to be broken off of you. And Christ Jesus is the one who breaks off every yoke. He will break that yoke off of you. He will deliver you out of the snare of darkness. And He'll do it over and over and again as many times as you come to Him. Maybe there's people that are here tonight, or you're watching me on the web or the YouTube, and you're going, "My, I just keep failing. I keep falling back into it." He'll keep delivering you out of it until you're willing to walk with Him. All you got to do is call upon His name. He's just that merciful. He's just that full of grace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Behold, He stands at the door and knocking. He says, "If any man will open up his heart to Me." It's more than opening up your head. It's opening up your heart, your affections, your passion. Turn yourself to Him. He said, "I will come in and fellowship with you." It is amazing. This is not just an allegory or a simile. This is a literal event in which God personally comes to us, touches us with His presence, with His glory. I know of no greater miracle. I know of no greater miracle. Because the thing about it is, dear people, I don't care what you talk about in terms of sickness and disease, a person can be healed and be made whole, and then ultimately to be cast into eternity, an eternal flame, an eternity without God. But the miracle of an encounter with Him, and the miracle of salvation, the miracle of change, to where that we can fellowship with the living God, and He becomes a living, real person to us in that exchange. There's nothing greater than that. Because there we find our guarantee of an eternity with Him. Tonight, if there's things in your life that you need to repent of them. Let God know that God hears you. And that the power now to live right is also present as well. The blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse you from every stain of sin. And the power of the Holy Spirit will live in you so you'll never sin again. Somebody said, "You telling me you never sin?" I'm telling you, I never want to sin. Somebody said, "You telling me you perfect?" I'm telling you, I want to be perfect as God described it. To have a perfect heart towards Him. To be perfect even as our Father in heaven is perfect. Somebody said, "You telling me you're holy?" Yes. And He demands that I be holy just like He's holy. He didn't make it of a lesser degree, because He's made us one. He's made us one. It's Himself. He's empowered us with this abundant life. And I pray tonight in Jesus' name that every one of you will understand it. You'll grab a hold of it. You won't quit. You'll stop just putting it off. You won't give up, but you'll press in. You'll recognize your need for Him. You'll recognize that the reading of the Bible is like a contact point, if you would. The Word of God is spirit and life, as I told you, but it's like a contact point as well. It's like a faith contact with God. It's like a state of yielding to Him and submitting yourself to Him. It's so beautiful, and you just grab a hold of it and begin to do it. Do you understand that prayer is far more than what we've religiously made it? It's an opportunity now to begin to give yourself to the flow of the Holy Spirit through your life so that you now have a continual, ongoing activity of the grace of God in your life that causes you to mature and grow in it and become stronger in it. And you don't have to be anywhere but along with God to do it privately, publicly. There's no limits. You can do it 24 hours a day if you could. Somebody said, how is it possible to pray without ceasing? Well, once you find this realm, you'll want to. You'll want to. I said, you'll want to. I said, once you find this realm, you'll want to. You'll want to. It won't be manipulation. It won't be control. It won't be religious activity. It won't be somebody putting pressure on you. There's an invitation. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Dear people, you are the only Jesus that most people will ever see. You're the only Jesus. And Jesus wants to be fully revealed to your life. So start looking at yourself. Don't let God down. I was so impacted by A.A. Allen the other night when I was watching him on a YouTube. And a woman came up, was deaf in one ear, and he said, listen, you said you had faith and that you knew Jesus was going to heal you. Now don't let him down. I said, that is beautiful. Where's that kind of preaching? Where's that kind of responsibility? Where's that willingness to be that kind of accountable? Oh, come on. Right here. Right here. Amen? If there's anybody here tonight you want prayer, if there's anybody here you feel like you've gone wayward, you've backslidden, you're not right with God, you're uncertain of your salvation, you're sick or diseased in your body, tormented in your mind, have any kind of addiction going on in your life, it just seems that you can't get the thing broken. First and foremost, I want you to understand we're here to pray with you and for you. And you're going to have to believe that God, what God is going to do is not just another dry run, that it's a reality of what God has done through His only begotten Son. You'll be touched by His presence here in this place. But then you're going to have to be willing to participate with God and obey God. Father's going to give you the spirit of obedience, the Holy Ghost. But you're going to have to be willing to walk in Him and obey Him. And also, I want to give you an opportunity, especially if you're sad tonight and you're full of the love of God, you know God, and you know that you're full of the Holy Ghost, but you're just kind of sad and feeling a little bit bummed, you need to give a huge offering. Because as you just give, it's just like it's just releasing. And somebody said, are we buying something? No, you're getting rid of something. You get something out of the way. I don't know what it is. It's just spiritual. I can't explain it, but I know that there's, when we begin to give, something gets released in our spirit to yield to God the Holy Ghost. You start giving, you get happy. I pray that every one of you under the cloud of glory like I am right now. And I pray that if you're not, that you soon get into this realm. And understand that all this is available for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, for the rest of forever. Amen. So just come worship the Lord. If you need prayer for anything, come. We'll pray with you and pray for you. The Lord will touch you. never been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, but the evidence is speaking in tongues, that wonderful language of the Spirit. Somebody said, what is that language of the Spirit? What is speaking in tongues? It's God speaking through you. People look at me curious and said, can you prove that in the Word? Yeah. They all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Guess who the Holy Ghost is? God. That's God speaking through you. Do you understand? We just devoted ourselves to not speak anything, say anything, unless it's in the Word of God, clearly in the Word of God. And we're just more passionate about it than ever before. And I'm just looking for ways to make sure that none of my words are involved. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. God the Father is here to strengthen you tonight. God the Son, Christ Jesus, He's here to strengthen you tonight. He ever lives to pray for you. He finds His joy in His existence. Just in it, making intercession. For He ever liveth. It's as though He's finding His whole meaning of life and purpose of living, interceding for you. God, the Holy Spirit, is here tonight, interceding for you. So just go ahead and receive what He wants to give you. Don't be bound up in your doubt. Don't be bound up in your shame. Don't be bound up in your concern. Don't be bound up in your worry. Don't wonder if God is going to do it. Know that He is.
Yes.
Know that He's a faithful God who fulfills everything that He's promised. Watch what He does for you tonight. Hallelujah. What is it that you need?
I have ringing in the ears, so I can't hear.
That ringing? I command this ringing to go out of your ears right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I know you love the Word of God. I know you love the things of the Spirit of God. Now in the name of Jesus, you're going to begin to flow in the Holy Ghost in a greater way than you've ever flowed. You're going to begin to flow in joy. You're going to begin to flow in His love and His presence that just comes out of an overwhelming encounter with Him, just encountering Him. You know, I don't go after joy, I go after Jesus. And going after Him, joy comes. I don't go after, as it were, love, I go after His manifest presence, and in that, His love comes. Now the ringing stops in Jesus' name. The ringing stops. I command the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth for this ringing to stop. And I command the name of Jesus that faith begins to rise in your heart and you believe like never before. I command in Jesus' name that you begin to receive these things out of heaven. Hallelujah. And that everything that would stand in the way and try to prevent you has to get out of the way, has to move out of the way in Jesus' name. There, thank you, Jesus. So filled to overflow. Bitterest to fight. You can have whatever you want, you know. You actually can have whatever you want. Actually. As He says, that is what He says. Whatever you desire, believe that you receive it when you pray, and it shall be yours. Whatever you ask the Father in my name, I'll give it to you. Fire, God. In Jesus' name. Zoraman, to say it to Bikini. Zoraman, to say it to Bikini. Here's what the Lord says. Don't struggle with it. It's not yours to fix. It's not yours to fix. It's not even yours to be involved in. It's not even yours to discuss. It's not even yours to dialogue with. The dialogue with it is a yoke. It's only for you to give it over completely to the Father and completely, as it were, sidestep it and ignore it and not even be involved in it. For it is meaningless, it is nothingness, it doesn't belong to reality or to truth. It is a wonderful place to step into this that I'm describing to you right now, to recognize what you're supposed to be involved in and what you're not supposed to be involved in. And when you recognize that when it's not something you're supposed to be involved in and you're able to say, consistently do that, you're going to live a joyful and a peaceful life. I recognize I can hear a tone of strife. I can feel the spirit of it even. And I don't engage. I'm not giving myself to that. I like it over here where there is no strife. I don't engage. I'm not giving myself over to the argument. I'm not giving myself over to the worry, to the struggle. It's amazing to me how my microphone changes like that. It is amazing to me. Hallelujah. Te quiero sando por sande exeto iste perenea. Listen to me. We either get wisdom and recognize that we're going to start doing it God's way. We start reading the Bible to understand, what am I supposed to do? Understand, that is a different posture than many people have. When you begin to read the Bible to understand exactly what you're supposed to do, suddenly you get wisdom beyond your age. You get the wisdom of the ages. It's either that or you have to wait till you get really old before you start appreciating how you should have lived your life. I pray tonight that you will take heed unto the Word of God and you will quit making it up as you go and stop doing whatever it is that you think you need to be doing or should be doing and start walking one step at a time, following God, the Holy Ghost. One step at a time. You know who they had to follow? You know who they had to follow? Do you know who they had to follow? One step at a time. Because they had never passed this way before? Do you know who they had to follow? Can somebody tell me if you knew who they had to follow? Huh? Yeah, they did not. I'll give you one more clue, seeing as you didn't recognize the verse of Scripture. They were pressing over Jordan. Who did they have to follow? No. The priest that bore the glory of God upon their shoulders. Walking one step at a time in that which Father, the leadership which Father described, that He placed His anointing upon, that the Word of God unveils and the Word of God reveals. It's the Word of God that described. This is what we wanted. So it was the Word of God that they were following, because the Word of God said, this is what I want you to do. I want the priest to take a hold of the ark and bear it up upon their shoulders and let them go out up beyond the people about a quarter of a mile, maybe a bit more. And then you go one step at a time. You follow the priest bearing the ark, bearing the glory. You understand what I'm telling you? I want you to understand this. Many people have not made the connection. There's been so much abuse in leadership, they've not made the connection. That the Holy Ghost comes and begins to move through His leadership that He raises up to show the people where to go. And I'm so sorry that there's been so much wrong and there's been so many violations. That doesn't eliminate the reality of what Father has. Christ Jesus wants to reveal Himself through you. God the Holy Ghost wants to reveal Jesus through you. How much more is He going to reveal Jesus in His purpose and His will to those who He anoints with the Holy Spirit? To make known His word. We were always questioning, well, I don't know. I don't understand. Well, maybe it's not even given for you to understand. Maybe it's given for you to serve. I imagine Elisha didn't understand a lot of things Elijah did. And he was smart because he just served it. Well, I can't understand what this prophet is doing. I imagine Joshua didn't understand a lot of things that Moses did. He just served. You understand what I'm telling you? I can guarantee the disciples didn't understand a lot of things Jesus did. They're going, what is he talking about now? What is he saying now? Now where are we going with this? Can you believe that just happened? And all of the other kinds of things they could talk about. And what they did was they just served. Lord, this is a hard saying. Eat my flesh and drink my blood. This is a radical sermon that you preached today. We don't even know what you're talking about. But we have no place to go. We know who you are. We're going to serve you. There's a struggle that people have in their mind. And that struggle in the mind is for you to bring to an end, not God. That struggle in the mind comes to an end when you simply begin to obey God's word. And you don't allow the doubt and all the accusation and all of the debate and all the argument. I guarantee you, people who allow that struggle in their mind are argumentative. Because it will be manifested in every area of their life. They're always arguing. They're always questioning. Because they're constantly allowing an argument and a questioning to go on in their mind against God. And against His Word. You hear me? This is the way I minister. This is the way the Holy Ghost talks through me. What? Why? For your deliverance. Somebody says, well, what am I going to do? You're going to obey the word. You submit to the word. What do you want?
Well, what you just said.
I know. And that's very good. That's good. What's good? Hold this. That's good. Now you have to start at the beginning. You have to start at the beginning. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. And everything that the Father says, you just obey. And you begin to meditate on His word day and night. Begin to write it. Begin to memorize it. Walk around doing the dishes, taking care of the laundry, taking care of the babies. The word. Just have the Bible open in different places. Go look at another verse of Scripture. Praise Him. Thank Him. Worship Him. When the thoughts and the argument and the questioning goes, just begin it. Recognize it's a stronghold. It's a stronghold. And the only way that's going to be broken is you worship Him and as you praise Him. Not as you try to think it through or argue it through or wrestle it down the ground. Just go to the Word. Just go to the Word. Shut it down with the Word. Shut it down with praise. Shut it down with thanksgiving. Say, Holy Spirit, rise up in me. I don't want to be this one anymore. I don't want to think this one anymore. Walk in the mind of the Spirit. I want to walk in the mind of Christ. I want you to have control. I am done. I am done. And I want you now to begin. And I'm telling you, listen to me. God the Holy Spirit stands waiting for someone to say such things. God the Holy Ghost stands trembling to baptize such a heart, such a submission. I saw you in the parking lot tonight. The Spirit of the Lord said, that is a holy woman of God. One to be filled with the Spirit, walking in the glory, the manifestation of the Spirit. That's what I heard. Drenched with the glory of heaven. With every expression at which only the Holy Spirit can produce. This is what God intends for you. It's yours. What we have to do is agree with Him. So be strengthened, holy woman of God. Be strengthened by the Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name. A miracle happens for you tonight. A miracle happens for you, Nicole. A miracle happens for you tonight. Overwhelming peace of the Holy Ghost. This overwhelming peace of the Holy Ghost. This overwhelming peace that rules your heart and mind.
In Jesus' name.
Says, lift your hands towards heaven. See, you're hungrier than you've ever been before. You're more ready than you've ever been before. Hallelujah. And that's really all that it takes. Hallelujah. Flowing in the Holy Ghost. Flowing in the presence of the Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah. Just flowing in the realms of heaven from this day forward in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Like never before. A fresh wind of heaven. A fresh wind of confidence. A fresh wind of confidence. Mandasipaya. Estotori maya say. Something stronger, something more glorious, something more powerful, something more persuasive in God than ever before. That's yours. It's yours, faith. It's yours, faith. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Out of your belly flows these wonderful rivers
of the Holy Ghost. Mambraza des den le zuzezira. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
What is it that you want? What is it that you need? Hey, you know, it's tough to be alone. It really is. Father wants... You know, Father's purpose is to get people hooked up together in marriage that are rightly suited for one another. You know that? And really, hallelujah, there's something that seems like it's just incomplete when Father's purpose that for your life. And you've got to recognize that part and just leave that to the Father. But don't let it slow you down in who you are being complete in Him. Let it slow you down in terms of the way that you yield to the Holy Ghost and rely upon Him. Jesus. Now I interrupted you. I'm sorry. What was you going to say? That's good. That's all Father needs right there. That's all the Father needs, Brittany. That's all that he needs. Father's going to give you wisdom. See, Father opens up our eyes and gives us an understanding that we may be able to cooperate with Him more effectively. We may become, have an understanding heart about really what it is we're doing, because many times people go to prayer. I went to prayer for many years and didn't really know what I was doing. I didn't really realize that I was giving myself to an opportunity for the Holy Spirit to begin to express Himself through me and develop me in all the things that He wants to do and wants to say. Gives wisdom and gives insight so we know how to cooperate with Him more fully. That insight's yours. Because you grabbed a hold of it. I heard God the Holy Spirit talking to you tonight, and you just drinking it in. See, when you drink it in, it's yours. It's yours. See, the Word of God is powerful. It's living. It goes forth like a seed looking for somebody who's just desperate for it. And as soon as it finds that kind of soil, it immediately springs up, begins to produce fruit. Hallelujah. 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 Haropo sikina masaya. Halimasito romo satayana mekiche apotayo. Siya romon desikana mosataya. Satan, you will not torment and harass this mind in Jesus' name ever again. You dare try. The Holy Ghost is going to rise up in Brittany and cast down anything you try to do. You have nothing here. You flow in the Holy Ghost. You move as a member in the body of Christ. You function in the anointing. You watch God as He increases you more and more, because you are. I've never seen a time you were disconnected. And I tell you right now, people, if you want to understand more than anything else about moving in as a member in the body of Christ, you know, it's staying connected. It's staying apart. It's staying hooked up. It's staying like, you know, not a clogged pipe. The water of the Spirit is flowing out into you and then out of you. If it's not flowing into you and then out of you, clogged pipe. You know what I'm saying? Now you just walk in a greater anointing. I charge you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk in a greater anointing. I charge you by the power of the living God. What is it? Fear of the Lord. Makatai. Bring a handkerchief and oil. Pesura makatai, takamokasana katikana makataya. The oil. Sibirinaya. Sibirinisi aturamasatai. Ithratast. Ithratast. Fear of the Lord should be your strength, stability in God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you make this body completely whole in every way. I don't see that old spirit of affliction on you like I did. Isn't that good?
Woo! Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Zudastaya. Shidakuramashi. 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 In the name of Jesus Christ, I command every tormenting thing, every afflicting thing to leave out of your body and out of your spirit, out of your mind, in Jesus' name. Tita kudamashi. Tita kudamashi imature menasitka. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Annalyn, what is it that you need? You speak boldly to these things. You speak boldly to these things and confidently to these things, and you see, faith sees it done. See, faith sees it done.
Yes.
Huh? Faith sees it done. Hope is uncertain, but faith sees it done.
Yes.
Hope is uncertain, but has a, you know, is looking that maybe something good is going to turn out of it. But faith sees it done. Faith is a substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things that's not yet seen. Halabosa renea takade. You just walk in authority. You walk in boldness. Hallelujah. You walk in holy boldness and authority. You say, this way it's going to be. Listen to me. This is how it's going to be. You know, I don't pull that out from my own will. I don't get all boisterous from my own will. But for Father's will, I get really boisterous. Really boisterous. Because I know His will is essential. It cannot be compromised. It must be realized. It must be participated with, cooperated with, submitted to, bowed to. Hastabriki. It's a bold, bold faith. What is it that you want? And great certainty in Jesus' name. Great certainty. Don't let the concerns of things that you see overwhelm you. No, you just cast your care upon the Lord. Amen. You don't allow it to torment you. You don't wrestle, torment your mind or wrestle with it as though somehow you were going to supply that provision or the answer for it. But you cast your care upon the Lord and you look to him, for he's the miracle worker. He's the only one who can change it. You can't change nothing. Amen. I mean, God, the Holy Spirit gives me the ability just to ignore some things. It is a beautiful thing. Just ignore it. Huh? Hallelujah. Speak faith into it and command it to change. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the name of Jesus. Kita Roma Masata.
Yeah, stronger, more powerful. Stronger, more powerful, greater force of the flow of God's glory through your life. Stronger, more powerful.
Hallelujah. Yeah. 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 Sekatadanai. Sotaparanamo supanaya pai. Lesi pravatana. Every day. Hallelujah. 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 Sir Surne. You know, the interpretation is just right there. And the Satakina Mosikana, that Seremoratai, Dibinakadan, that produces that, Residitona, right beside of it, right integrated with it, is the same inspiration that begins to cause the word to come forth. Lord, I don't want it this way anymore. I want your will. I want your way. I'm tired of being entangled with the things that people say. I'm tired of being entangled with the words of men. I'm going to live by your word. She's the spirit of the Son crying. You know, our spirit begins to pray by the Holy Ghost, and there is a request that is for our own, is for our own need. Because he intercedes according to the mind of the Father concerning our infirmity or our need. There's things that are proclamations directly from God, and there's things that are proclamations right out of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Of the Son. And that's where I learned how to pray right there. I learned how to pray, kind of praying, letting the Holy Ghost cry out for me, through me, and then understanding what it was he was saying. Because out of that, see, that's how I understood what interpretation of tongues were, because I recognized that all of a sudden a newfound understanding of prayer came to me right after that burst of the Holy Ghost. So that inspiration that brought that burst of that thunderous tongue brought that burst of praying for what I really need. Hallelujah. 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 And then God just brings that right on over from our personal relationship. Where we begin to speak on his behalf. What an honor. What an honor to speak on behalf of God. What an honor to speak with the words that God the Holy Ghost is expressly declaring. What an honor! You'd think that people would give this up 12 hours a day to it if that's what it took to have it. And it don't even take that much. Don't even take half that much. God doesn't require of us more than what we're able. He knows where we're at and what we're going through. And he knows what responsibilities are upon our life and what commitments we've made. He knows how to take us from where we're at and if we're participate and nurture us to the fullness of that which he would have us to be. This is the way God works. This is the way God works. Hallelujah. It's what he described in his word and what he's described to me, through everybody I've ever seen participate with him. I guarantee you, you drop in on my life at any moment of the time of the day, and you'll find out I'm participating with God. I've never gone astray. I'm with him all the way. And we challenge you and call you. Come find a faithful God. Come find this faithful God that we now proclaim to you and make manifest to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Woo. Feel like dancing. Woo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bodhisattva. No, you can't have it your own way.
No, I don't want it my own way.
No, you can't have it your own way.
I don't want it my own way.
No, you can't have it.
I don't want it. Yeah. I don't want it my own way. Father, I only want your will.
Yeah.
No more.
Yeah.
I don't want any strife.
Yeah.
I don't want anything, Lord, that doesn't please you.
Yeah.
Father, I want more of you. I only want truth in my innermost being.
Yeah.
I want nothing to stop the flow of the anointing of my life.
Yeah.
I break its power in the name of Jesus. And it must go now from my life, Lord.
And it's just a yielding to the Holy Spirit. It's just a yielding to the Holy Spirit. See, the Lord said it so perfectly. I hope you don't find that as an amazing thing, but he said it so perfectly. He said, submit yourself to God. Let the flow of the Holy Ghost rise up on the inside of you. And then resist the devil. And watch what he's going to do. And I'm going to tell you right now, it don't take too many times of consistently saying, Satan, you don't have any right to touch me. I'm not yielding my emotion to you and my members to you. That God says that God comes and he steps in the middle of it. He steps in the middle of it. And he looks at that oppressive demon power and he said, I told you no more. And it's over. And most people can discover if they look in their life, there was things in their life at one time that they thought they were never going to get past. But then they found a grace in God because they kept participating. They kept reaching in. They kept crying out to God for his mercy. They kept coming in that place of repentance. And suddenly they found a place and a strength to say no. And they said no again. And then they said no again. And then they said no again. And then all of a sudden, Father stepped in and said, you out of here. You out. And then that addiction was broken. That problem ceased to exist. And it's not even a memory anymore, hardly. And so is everything else will follow suit the same way. From the great things, from the more, visible things, to the smaller things and the more invisible things. Hallelujah. You know, God does not have a finger of accusation. He has an invitation to come and be changed. When God speaks out what the problems are, the issues, it's not an accusation. It's a declaration that change must come. And when somebody wants change, steps right in and begins to help. But it has to be our will that steps forward first with him. And it's a beautiful thing. Your Father brings and establishes us in the truth. Hallelujah. In commitment. Into doing it right. Amen. And it's good to have great help around. Spiritual help around. Hallelujah. See, my wife and these are microphones, I'm telling you. Jesus, I'm sure that there's better technology out there somewhere. But at any rate, what I want to say, I got it. But what we did was we committed ourselves. If there's the church doors are open, we hear. That's God's leadership. Any other examples is wrong leadership. Do not follow them. Do not listen to what they say. Pray for them, but do not follow them and do not listen to them. Because they have not committed themselves to the right way yet. They're still in a decision-making process. Love them, pray for them, but do not follow them. Because when you make those commitments that we've made as leadership, we always in the meeting. And we want to be in more meetings. Right? We want to be in meetings. We don't feel right if we're not in the meeting. That's why we have the meeting in our house, in our own lives. We won't be in the meeting. And because we want to be in the meeting in the secret place, God's going to make sure we get in the meeting in the public place. Do you hear what I'm saying? Yes. So it's good to have good help when you hooked up. And husbands and wives, you need to be this way. You think I'll tell you right now, listen to me. If I was in the hospital and I was there and paralyzed, and all I had was my chin moving, I would flop myself down on the ground and I'd start pulling myself by my chin to get to church. I guarantee you I wouldn't be paralyzed long, man. I'm committed. I don't care what's going on. I don't care what's going down. Be in the meeting. Amen. Commit yourself to it. Get on the same page. Don't tell your wife or your husband, oh, we need to sit down and talk about our problems. Say, listen, let's get in the Holy Ghost prayer meeting. See the power of God begin to move. I don't need to turn my wife into a psychologist. Nor do I need to be a psychoanalyst, psychoanalyzing myself. Nor vice versa. And I watch people do this. I see it because I can hear it in their questions. I can see sometimes in their attitudes. Don't do that. That's mind thing. That's human thing. You're not going to find any help there, a miracle there. Say, let's call upon the name of the Lord. Let the fire of God come down on the situation. Amen. Huh? Let me say this. If I have a bad attitude towards my wife, if for any reason, it is an indication to me that I'm not flowing in the Holy Ghost. Does that sound surprising to you? Now, can you turn that on yourself? What do you do? If I've just had an indication I'm not flowing in the Holy Ghost, you know what I do? I repent on the spot. I don't say, yeah, I'm not flowing in the Holy Ghost. I don't really want to. Because you got to be saying something in your head, right? Unless you just normally do unthinking things, which I don't believe. You just say, Holy Ghost, I'm sorry for my attitude. I'm feeling strengthen me right now. And then if I've said anything, I repent. Say, baby, I'm sorry. That wasn't right. And never make an excuse. I say, there's no excuse for it. I'm sorry, I didn't do right. And she's not going to have to wait till next week. Or the afternoon either. Amen? Why? We committed to God. We committed to walking in the Word and walking in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Better watch out. This microphone's going to start exploding on us. Thank you, Jesus. What is it that would you like besides joy?
Yes, I do need joy. When you just mentioned the Lord is here to strengthen us, and I just believe that. And then I was thinking change, and then you said a minute ago, you said change. So I'm believing the Lord for that, just the strength to receive from Him. And just that change. And then also, I have to go to a Halloween party on Friday because my car is broken. And I'm so bummed about that. I was trying to get out of it. It's at work. And I don't know how to go and sit there and pretend like it's okay when I know that it's not. Yet at the same time, not be like, I don't know. So,
there's a list there.
Okay.
I'm kind of stuck on why you have to go to a Halloween party.
Broken. I have nowhere to go, and it's at the reception desk. I'm the receptionist. It's right in front of me, and I have nowhere to go, so I can leave for an hour for my
dress
lunch.
Up like an angel.
Really? Should I?
Well, I mean, it's, you know what, you're surely not going to be a witness of Jesus sitting there with a sourpuss.
Exactly.
Look on your face. Huh?
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Sitting there mad at the world.
Right.
Huh?
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, I do.
If you got to be there, if there's no way out of it, then you better make some kind of a witness out of the thing. If there's no way out of it and you got to be there, you can't excuse yourself, then I would say that God wants you to be there. Okay. And He wants you to stand there looking like a hate monger.
with a cross. Of course, that might not be a bad idea, or dress up like a cross. People say, what are you? I'm the cross of Christ. That breaks all the yokes of Halloween. Who knows? I mean, you gotta get creative with it. I mean, you know, say, let God be God. You gotta be smiley, joyful. See, if you're sad, you're gonna fit in really well. But if you're happy, you're gonna stand out. You know, you're like, what is up with you? No, I just recognize. Listen, you know what? Listen, Timmy. Listen. The Lord's mindful and concerned about what you have need of. He knows. Don't get sorrowful thinking that you're on your own here. He knows what you have need of. You know, let me just say this. I prayed for so many hurting people and felt the pain of that hurt. And the terror that hurt, and the torment of that hurt, and the agony of that hurt, to the point where I didn't want to hurt anyone. I don't want to hurt anyone. And, you know, the beautiful thing about it is the Lord, the way that the Lord Jesus is so mindful of the hurt, he just goes right to the hurt to heal it. So you're not on your own. Believe me. You need to get your imagination working right. You need a temple of the Holy Ghost. That'd be a good thing to go as a temple. What are you? I'm the temple of the Holy Ghost. Halloween ghost, right? Touch him right now. What you need? What's up?
Just the more of the Holy Ghost.
Uh-huh. You need what?
More of the Holy Ghost.
You need more of him? Lord Jesus, give him more of you. Holy Spirit, he wants more of you. He wants more of you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Say, I'm all for the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is all for me. Hey. One for all and all for one. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, how are you doing, man? You doing good? You look good. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You look good. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Everything's working out right. You're not drooping over here anymore. Isn't that good? You're such a miracle.
Yes.
For men to go on the inside of your brain, start messing with your brain, and everything's still good. It is wonder. The Lord loves you very much. And we do too. What do you want? What do you want the Lord to do for you? Okay. He wants more of you. Father, I ask in your mercy and your goodness, cause your servant to be overwhelmed by your presence. Let him learn how to flow in the anointing, just like Joshua and Daniel and Elizabeth and Ruth Ann learn how to flow in the anointing. You know how they learn how to flow in the anointing? Being in it. True. They saw mom and dad admiring the anointing, just caught up in the anointing. Not a struggle. A praise. It's true. It's true. And that's the way it works.
Then there's, I've heard people say, well, I don't see it that way. Well, you know what? Go with whatever you think. I hope it works out good for you. You know what I did? I looked at people who had good results and followed them. Huh? Amen. Amen. Just watch the people get good results. Follow them. Does that make sense? If the farmer next to you, his watermelons are this big around, right? And your watermelon's this big around, you know what you ought to do? You ought to go do what he's doing. Because it's the same soil. Hello. Now I believe it like this. Well, you're going to just get your little whatever. Doesn't that make sense? And Father's given us the beauty. Amen. Take off your shoes. Amen. From off your feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Father gets so excited. Listen to me. Father gets so excited about us being captivated by the anointing and wanting the anointing. Seeing it and being hungry for it. Seeing it and being thirsty for it. It's the one thing he told us that we could covet. You see? Spiritual gifts, the manifestation of the anointing, the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Just when you see the anointing, the thing, just get excited about the anointing. The beautiful thing of it is it's always around here. I'm always functioning in it. I don't preach without the anointing. Hallelujah. Praise God. And if you do it, if you get excited about the things of the Spirit, where there's miracles or ministry by the Spirit in the Word, she's on a mission. And it's a smart approach. Amen. We're gonna get a hold of her, I promise you. Anna and Naomi, are you guys doing laps in the anointing? Are we doing laps in the anointing? Come, baby, come sit over here. We're not quite done. We're almost done. Give us a few more minutes. Father, we thank you right now. Yes, that's right. Just lift those hands towards heaven. Right now in Jesus' name. Come here. I'm going to go over here and pray for Jonathan. Okay, I'm going to come get you. I'm going to take care for. I'm going to take care. We're going to go pray for Jonathan. I'm going to come back and get you, okay? And then we'll close out with you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Are you ready, Jonathan? Are you ready? Are you ready? Don't stay in a ready position. That's it, ready. That's the I fly away position. That's a get caught away in position. I'm caught away. In Jesus' name. Just take hold of whatever you want right now in God. Yeah, just take hold of it, yeah. Yes. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, that's right. That's a good word. Good one. Amen. You just keep doing that. You keep doing that, and you'll be strengthened now in Jesus' name. See, I see change.
Yeah.
I see change. I don't see the same harassing things gripping your mind. And the things that that may even continue to be, I see them being broken. Yes. Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. I speak great peace into your spirit. That the peace of God will rule your heart and your mind. Yes. Yeah, you know why? You know why, Jonathan? Because you washed in blood and born of the Spirit. Hallelujah. You washed in, you belong to. Your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Yes. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yay. Yay.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Yeah, just go pray for her. Amen. We promise to close out. Everybody just stand with me. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Cage, you might have to edit out the first 5 minutes of for the YouTube. Maybe it should stay in. Hallelujah. Because people who can't agree with that ain't going to understand a single thing that was said after that either.
Absolutely.
So might as well. Why should a person waste their time watching the whole thing? Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Hey, are you happy to be here?
Yeah.
Happy to be in the presence of the Lord? Do you take it for granted? You take for granted the anointing of the Holy Ghost that's in the house? I encourage you to go visit a few churches. Just go hang on a couple of days. Go visit a few churches. Just be excited about Jesus. Be excited about the anointing. I'm going to tell you, people, the most beautiful and wonderful thing is the movings of God. Just be passionate about it. Just want to be in the big middle of it desperately, and you will be, okay? Find a bunch of people, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. And I love you so much.